This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. The Prince and the Pauper by Mark Twain. Hugh Latimer, Bishop of Worcester, to Lord Cromwell on the birth of the Prince of Wales, afterward Edward the Sixth, from the National Manuscripts preserved by the British Government. Right Honourable, Salutem in Christo Jesu, and sir, here is no less younger and rejoicing in these parties for the birth of our prince, whom we hungered for so long, than there was, I trow, inter vicinos, at the birth of S. I. Baptista, as these bearer master events can tell you. God give us all a grace to yield a due thanks to our Lord God, God of England. For verily he hath showed himself God of England, or rather an English God. If we consider and ponder well all his proceedings with us from time to time, he hath overcome all our illness with his exceeding goodness, so that we are now more than compelled to serve him, seek his glory, promote his word, if the devil of all devils be not in us. We have now the stoop of vain trusts, and the stay of vain expectations. Let us all pray for his preservation, and I for my part will wish that his grace always have, and even now from the beginning, governors, instructors, and officers of right judgment. Ne optimum ingenium non optima educatione depravitur. But what a great fowl am I, so what devotion show many times but little discretion, and thus the God of England be ever with you in all your proceedings. The 19 of October, yours H.L.B. of Worcester, now at Hattlebury. If you would excite this bearer to be more hearty in the abuse of imagery, or more forward to promote the verity, ye might do good. Not that it came of me, but of yourself, etc. Addressed to the Right Honourable Lord P. Seal, his singular good Lord. Dedication to those good-mannered and agreeable children, Susie and Clara Clemens, this book is affectionately inscribed by their father. The quality of mercy is twice blessed. It blesseth him that gives and him that takes. 'Tis mightiest in the mightiest. It becomes the throned monarch better than his crown. Merchant of Venice. I will set down a tale as it was told to me by one who had it of his father, which latter had it of his father, this last having in like manner had it of his father, and so on back and still back 300 years and more, the fathers transmitting it to the sons and so preserving it. It may be history. It may be only a legend, a tradition. It may have happened, it may not have happened, but it could have happened. It may be that the wise and the learned believed it in the old days. It may be that only the unlearned and the simple loved it and credited it. Chapter 1. The Birth of the Prince and the Pauper. In the ancient city of London, on a certain autumn day in the second quarter of the 16th century, a boy was born to a poor family of the name of Canty, who did not want him. On the same day another English child was born to a rich family of the name of Tudor, who did want him. All England wanted him, too. England had so longed for him, and hoped for him, and prayed God for him, that now that he was really come, the people went nearly mad for joy. Mere acquaintances hugged and kissed each other, and cried. Everybody took a holiday, and high and low, rich and poor, feasted and danced and sang and got very mellow, and they kept this up for days and nights together. By day London was a sight to see, with gay banners waving from every balcony and housetop, and splendid pageants marching along. By night it was again a sight to see, with its great bonfires at every corner, and its troops of revellers making merry around them. There was no talk in all England but of the new baby, Edward Tudor, Prince of Wales, who lay lapped in silks and satins, unconscious of all this fuss, and not knowing that great lords and ladies were tending him and watching over him, and not caring either. But there was no talk about the other baby, Tom Canty, lapped in his poor rags, except among the family of paupers whom he had just come to trouble with his presence. Chapter 2. Tom's Early Life. Let us skip a number of years. London was 1,500 years old, and was a great town for that day. It had 100,000 inhabitants, some think double as many. The streets were very narrow and crooked and dirty, especially in the part where Tom Canty lived, which was not far from London Bridge. The houses were of wood, with the second story projecting over the first, and the third sticking its elbows out beyond the second. The higher the houses grew, the broader they grew. They were skeletons of strong criss-cross beams, with solid material between, coated with plaster. The beams were painted red or blue or black, according to the owner's taste, and this gave the houses a very picturesque look. The windows were small, glazed with little diamond-shaped panes, and they opened outward on hinges, like doors. The house which Tom's father lived in was up a foul little pocket called Offal Court, out of Pudding Lane. It was small, decayed, and rickety, but it was packed full of wretchedly poor families. Canty's tribe occupied a room on the third floor. The mother and father had a sort of bedstead in the corner, but Tom, his grandmother, and his two sisters, Bet and Nan, were not restricted. They had all the floor to themselves, and might sleep where they chose. There were the remains of a blanket or two, and some bundles of ancient and dirty straw, but these could not rightly be called beds, for they were not organized. They were kicked into a general pile mornings, and selections made from the mass at night for service. Bet and Nan were 15 years old, twins. They were good-hearted girls, unclean, clothed in rags, and profoundly ignorant. Their mother was like them, but the father and the grandmother were a couple of fiends. They got drunk whenever they could. Then they fought each other or anybody else who came in the way. They cursed and swore always, drunk or sober. John Canty was a thief, and his mother a beggar. They made beggars of the children, but failed to make thieves of them. Among, but not of, the dreadful rabble that inhabited the house, was a good old priest whom the king had turned out of house and home with a pension of a few farthings, and he used to get the children aside and teach them right ways secretly. Father Andrew also taught Tom a little Latin, and how to read and write, and would have done the same with the girls, but they were afraid of the jeers of their friends, who could not have endured such a queer accomplishment in them. All Offal Court was just such another hive as Canty's house. Drunkenness, riot, and brawling were the order there every night, and nearly all night long. Broken heads were as common as hunger in that place. Yet little Tom was not unhappy. He had a hard time of it, but did not know it. It was the sort of time that all the Offal Court boys had. Therefore he supposed it was the correct and comfortable thing. When he came home empty-handed at night, he knew his father would curse him and thrash him first, and that when he was done the awful grandmother would do it all over again and improve on it, and that, away in the night, his starving mother would slip to him stealthily with any miserable scrap or crust she had been able to save for him by going hungry herself. Notwithstanding, she was often caught in that sort of treason, and soundly beaten for it by her husband. No, Tom's life went along well enough, especially in summer. He only begged just enough to save himself, for the laws against mendicancy were stringent, and the penalties heavy. So he put in a good deal of his time listening to good Father Andrew's charming old tales and legends about giants and fairies, dwarfs and genii, and enchanted castles, and gorgeous kings and princes. His head grew to be full of these wonderful things, and many a night as he lay in the dark on his scant and offensive straw, tired, hungry, and smarting from a thrashing, he unleashed his imagination and soon forgot his aches and pains in delicious picturings to himself of the charmed life of a petted prince in a regal palace. One desire came in time to haunt him day and night. It was to see a real prince with his own eyes. He spoke of it once to some of his Offal Court comrades, but they jeered him and scoffed him so unmercifully that he was glad to keep his dream to himself after that. He often read the priest's old books and got him to explain and enlarge upon them. His dreamings and readings worked certain changes in him by and by. His dream people were so fine that he grew to lament his shabby clothing and his dirt, and to wish to be clean and better clad. He went on playing in the mud just the same, and enjoying it, too. But instead of splashing around in the Thames solely for the fun of it, he began to find an added value in it because of the washings and cleansings it afforded. Tom could always find something going on around the Maypole in Cheapside and at the fairs, and now and then he and the rest of London had a chance to see a military parade when some famous unfortunate was carried prisoner to the Tower by land or boat. One summer's day he saw poor Anne Askew and three men burned at the stake in Smithfield, and heard an ex-bishop preach a sermon to them which did not interest him. Yes, Tom's life was varied and pleasant enough, on the whole. By and by Tom's reading and dreaming about princely life wrought such a strong effect upon him that he began to act the prince unconsciously. His speech and manners became curiously ceremonious and courtly, to the vast admiration and amusement of his intimates. But Tom's influence among these young people began to grow now, day by day, and in time he came to be looked up to by them with a sort of wondering awe as a superior being. He seemed to know so much, and he could do and say such marvelous things, and withal he was so deep and wise. Tom's remarks and Tom's performances were reported by the boys to their elders, and these also presently began to discuss Tom Canty and to regard him as a most gifted and extraordinary creature. Full-grown people brought their perplexities to Tom for solution, and were often astonished at the wit and wisdom of his decisions. In fact, he was become a hero to all who knew him except his own family. These only saw nothing in him. Privately, after a while, Tom organized a royal court. He was the prince. His special comrades were guards, chamberlains, equerries, lords, and ladies-in-waiting, and the royal family. Daily the mock prince was received with elaborate ceremonials borrowed by Tom from his romantic readings. Daily the great affairs of the mimic kingdom were discussed in the royal council, and daily his mimic highness issued decrees to his imaginary armies, navies, and vice-royalties. After which he could go forth in his rags and beg a few farthings, eat his poor crust, take his customary cuffs and abuse, and then stretch himself upon his handful of foul straw, and resume his empty grandeurs in his dreams. And still his desire to look just once upon a real prince, in the flesh, grew upon him, day by day and week by week, until at last it absorbed all other desires, and became the one passion of his life. One January day, on his usual begging tour, he tramped despondently up and down the region round about Mincing Lane and Little East Cheap, hour after hour, barefooted and cold, looking in at cookshop windows and longing for the dreadful pork pies and other deadly inventions displayed there, for to him these were dainties fit for the angels, that is, judging by the smell they were, for it had never been his good luck to own and eat one. There was a cold drizzle of rain, the atmosphere was murky, it was a melancholy day. At night Tom reached home so wet and tired and hungry that it was not possible for his father and grandmother to observe his forlorn condition and not be moved, after their fashion. Wherefore they gave him a brisk cuffing at once and sent him to bed. For a long time his pain and hunger, and the swearing and fighting going on in the building, kept him awake. But at last his thoughts drifted away to far romantic lands, and he fell asleep in the company of jeweled and gilded princelings, who lived in vast palaces, and had servants salaaming before them or flying to execute their orders, and then, as usual, he dreamed that he was a princeling himself. All night long the glories of his royal estate shone upon him. He moved among great lords and ladies, in a blaze of light, breathing perfumes, drinking in delicious music, and answering the reverent obeisances of the glittering throng as it parted to make way for him, with here a smile and there a nod of his princely head. And when he awoke in the morning and looked upon the wretchedness about him, his dream had had its usual effect. It had intensified the sordidness of his surroundings a thousandfold. Then came bitterness, and heartbreak, and tears. Chapter 3. Tom's Meeting with the Prince. Tom got up hungry and sauntered hungry away, but with his thoughts busy with the shadowy splendors of his night's dreams. He wandered here and there in the city, hardly noticing where he was going or what was happening around him. People jostled him, and some gave him rough speech, but it was all lost on the musing boy. By and by he found himself at Temple Bar, the furthest from home he had ever traveled in that direction. He stopped and considered a moment, then fell into his imaginings again and passed on, outside the walls of London. The Strand had ceased to be a country road then, and regarded itself as a street, but by a strained construction, for though there was a tolerably compact row of houses on one side of it, there were only some scattering great buildings on the other, these being palaces of rich nobles, with ample and beautiful grounds stretching to the river, grounds that are now closely packed with grim acres of brick and stone. Tom discovered Charing Village, presently, and rested himself at the beautiful cross built there by a bereaved king of earlier days, then idled down a quiet, lovely road past the great cardinal's stately palace, toward a far more mighty and majestic palace beyond, Westminster. Tom stared in glad wonder at the vast pile of masonry, the wide-spreading wings, the frowning bastions and turrets, the huge stone gateway with its gilded bars and its magnificent array of colossal granite lions and other the signs and symbols of English royalty. Was the desire of his soul to be satisfied at last? Here indeed was a king's palace. Might he not hope to see a prince now, a prince of flesh and blood, if heaven were willing? At each side of the gilded gate stood a living statue, that is to say, an erect and stately and motionless man-at-arms, clad from head to heel in shining steel armor. At a respectful distance were many country folk, and people from the city waiting for any chance glimpse of royalty that might offer. Splendid carriages with splendid people in them, and splendid servants outside, were arriving and departing by several other noble gateways that pierced the royal enclosure. Poor little Tom in his rags approached and was moving slow and timidly past the sentinels, with a beating heart and a rising hope, when all at once he caught sight, through the golden bars, of a spectacle that almost made him shout for joy. Within was a comely boy, tanned and brown with sturdy outdoor sports and exercises, whose clothing was all of lovely silks and satins, shining with jewels, at his hip a little jeweled sword and dagger, dainty buskins on his feet, with red heels, and on his head a jaunty crimson cap with drooping plumes fastened with a great sparkling gem. Several gorgeous gentlemen stood near, his servants without a doubt. Oh, he was a prince, a prince, a living prince, a real prince, without the shadow of a question, and the prayer of the pauper boy's heart was answered at last. Tom's breath came quick and short with excitement, and his eyes grew big with wonder and delight. Everything gave way in his mind instantly to one desire, and that was to get close to the prince and have a good, devouring look at him. Before he knew what he was about, he had his face against the gate bars. The next instant one of the soldiers snatched him rudely away and sent him spinning among the gaping crowd of country gawks and London idlers. The soldier said, "Mind thy manners, thou young beggar!" The crowd jeered and laughed, but the young prince sprang to the gate with his face flushed and his eyes flashing with indignation, and cried out, "How darest thou use a poor lad like that? How darest thou use the king, my father's meanest subject, so? Open the gates and let him in." You should have seen that fickle crowd snatch off their hats then. You should have heard them cheer and shout, "Long live the Prince of Wales!" The soldiers presented arms with their halberds, opened the gates, and presented again as the little Prince of Poverty passed in his fluttering rags, to join hands with the Prince of Limitless Plenty. Edward Tudor said, "Thou lookest tired and hungry. Thou'st been treated ill. Come with me." Half a dozen attendants sprang forward to, I don't know what, interfere, no doubt, but they were waved aside with a right royal gesture, and they stopped stock still where they were, like so many statues. Edward took Tom to a rich apartment in the palace, which he called his cabinet. By his command a repast was brought, such as Tom had never encountered before except in books. The prince, with princely delicacy and breeding, sent away the servants, so that his humble guest might not be embarrassed by their critical presence. Then he sat nearby and asked questions while Tom ate. "What is thy name, lad?"
"Tom Canty, an it please thee, sir."
"'Tis an odd one. Where dost live?"
"In the city, please thee, sir. Offal Court, out of Pudding Lane."
"Offal Court? Truly, 'tis another odd one. Hast parents?"
"Parents have I, sir, and a grand dam likewise, that is but indifferently precious to me, God forgive me if it be offensive to say it. Also twin sisters, Nan and Bet."
"Then is thy grandam not overkind to thee, I take it?"
"Neither to any other is she, so please your worship. She hath a wicked heart, and worketh evil all her days."
"Doth she mistreat thee?"
"There be times that she stayeth her hand, being asleep or overcome with drink. But when she hath her judgment clear again, she maketh it up to me with goodly beatings."
A fierce look came into the little prince's eyes, and he cried out,
"What? Beatings?"
"Oh, indeed, yes, please you, sir."
"Beatings?
And thou so frail and little!
Harkee, before the night come, she shall hie her to the tower. The king, my father—"
"In sooth, you forget, sir, her low degree. The tower is for the great alone."
"True, indeed. I had not thought of that. I will consider of her punishment. Is thy father kind to thee?"
"Not more than Gammer Canty, sir."
"Fathers be alike, mayhap. Mine hath not a doll's temper. He smiteth with a heavy hand, yet spareth me. He spareth me not always with his tongue, though, sooth to say. How doth thy mother use thee?"
"She is good, sir, and giveth me neither sorrow nor pain of any sort, and Nan and Bet are like to her in this."
"How old be these?"
15, an it please you, sir."
"The Lady Elizabeth, my sister, is 14, and the Lady Jane Grey, my cousin, is of mine own age, and comely and gracious withal.
But my sister, the Lady Mary, with her gloomy mien, and—"
"Look you, do thy sisters forbid their servants to smile, lest the sin destroy their souls?"
"They? Oh, dost think, sir, that they have servants?"
The little prince contemplated the little pauper gravely a moment, then said,
"And prithee, why not? Who helpeth them undress at night? Who attireth them when they rise?"
"None, sir. Wouldst have them take off their garment and sleep without, like the beasts?"
"Their garment? Have they but one?"
"Ah, good your worship, what would they do with more? Truly they have not two bodies each."
"It is a quaint and marvellous thought. Thy pardon, I had not meant to laugh. But thy good Nan and thy Bet shall have raiment and lackeys enow, and that soon, too.
My cofferer shall look to it. No, thank me not, 'tis nothing. Thou speakest well. Thou hast an easy grace in it. Art learned?"
"I know not if I am or not, sir. The good priest that is called Father Andrew taught me of his kindness from his books."
"Knowest thou the Latin?"
"But scantly, sir, I doubt."
"Learn it, lad. 'Tis hard only at first. The Greek is harder. But neither these nor any tongues else, I think, are hard to the Lady Elizabeth and my cousin. Thou shouldst hear those damsels at it.
But tell me of thy Offal Court. Hast thou a pleasant life there?"
"In truth, yes, so please you, sir, save when one is hungry. There be Punch and Judy shows, and monkeys, oh, such antic creatures, and so bravely dressed. And there be plays, wherein they that play do shout and fight till all are slain, and 'tis so fine to see, and costeth but a farthing, albeit 'tis main hard to get the farthing, please your worship."
"Tell me more."
"We lads of Offal Court do strive against each other with the cudgel, like to the fashion of the princes, sometimes."
The prince's eyes flashed. Said he, "Marry, that would not I mislike. Tell me more."
"We strive in races, sir, to see who of us shall be fleetest."
"That would I like also. Speak on."
"In summer, sir, we wade and swim in the canals and in the river, and each doth duck his neighbor, and spatter him with water, and dive and shout and tumble, and 'twould be worth my father's kingdom but to enjoy it once. Prithee, go on."
"We dance and sing about the maypole in Cheapside, we play in the sand, each covering his neighbor up, and times we make mud pastry. Oh, the lovely mud! It hath not its like for delightfulness in all the world. We do fairly wallow in the mud, sir, saving your worship's presence."
"Oh, prithee, say no more. 'Tis glorious. If that I could but clothe me in raiment like to thine, and strip my feet and revel in the mud once, just once, with none to rebuke me or forbid, meseemeth I could forego the crown."
And if that I could clothe me once, sweet sir, as thou art clad, just once—
Ho, ho, wouldst like it? Then so shall it be. Doff thy rags and don these splendors, lad. It is a brief happiness, but will be not less keen for that. We will have it while we may, and change again before any come to molest. A few minutes later the little Prince of Wales was garlanded with Tom's fluttering odds and ends, and the little Prince of Pauperdom was tricked out in the gaudy plumage of royalty. The two went and stood side by side before a great mirror, and lo, a miracle! There did not seem to have been any change made. They stared at each other, then at the glass, then at each other again. At last the puzzled princeling said, "What dost thou make of this?"
"Ah, good your worship, require me not to answer. It is not meet that one of my degree should utter the thing."
"Then will I utter it. Thou hast the same hair, the same eyes, the same voice and manner, the same form and stature, the same face and countenance that I bear. Fared we forth naked, there is none could say which was you and which the Prince of Wales. And now that I am clothed as thou wert clothed, it seemeth I should be able the more nearly to feel as thou didst when the brute soldier— Harkee, is not this a bruise upon your hand?"
"Yes, but it is a slight thing, and your worship knoweth that the poor man-at-arms—"
"Peace! It was a shameful thing and a cruel," cried the little prince, stamping his bare foot. "If the king— stir not a step till I come again. It is a command." In a moment he had snatched up and put away an article of national importance that lay upon a table, and was out at the door and flying through the palace grounds in his bannered rags, with a hot face and glowing eyes. As soon as he reached the great gate he seized the bars and tried to shake them, shouting, "Open! Unbar the gates!" The soldier that had maltreated Tom obeyed promptly, and as the prince burst through the portal, half smothered with royal wrath, the soldier fetched him a sounding box on the ear that sent him whirling to the roadway, and said, "Take that, thou beggar's spawn, for what thou got'st me from his highness!" The crowd roared with laughter. The prince picked himself out of the mud, and made fiercely at the sentry, shouting, "I am the Prince of Wales! My person is sacred, and thou shalt hang for laying thy hand upon me!" The soldier brought his halbert to present arms, and said mockingly, "I salute your gracious highness!" Then angrily, "Be off, thou crazy rubbish!" Here the jeering crowd closed around the poor little prince, and hustled him far down the road, hooting him and shouting, "Way for his royal highness! Way for the Prince of Wales!" End of chapter 3.
Chapter 4. The Prince's Troubles Begin. After hours of persistent pursuit and persecution, the little prince was at last deserted by the rabble and left to himself. As long as he had been able to rage against the mob, and threaten it royally, and royally utter commands that were good stuff to laugh at, he was very entertaining. But when weariness finally forced him to be silent, he was no longer of use to his tormentors, and they sought amusement elsewhere. He looked about him now, but could not recognize the locality. He was within the city of London, that was all he knew. He moved on aimlessly, and in a little while the houses thinned, and the passers-by were infrequent. He bathed his bleeding feet in the brook which flowed then where Farrington Street now is, rested a few moments, then passed on, and presently came upon a great space with only a few scattered houses in it, and a prodigious church. He recognized this church. Scaffoldings were about, everywhere, and swarms of workmen, for it was undergoing elaborate repairs. The prince took heart at once. He felt that his troubles were at an end now. He said to himself, "It is the ancient Grey Friars' church, which the king my father hath taken from the monks, and given for a home for ever, for poor and forsaken children, and new named it Christ Church. Right gladly will they serve the son of him who hath done so generously by them, and the more that that son is himself as poor and as forlorn as any that be sheltered here this day, or ever shall be." He was soon in the midst of a crowd of boys who were running, jumping, playing at ball and leapfrog, and otherwise disporting themselves, and right noisily, too. They were all dressed alike, and in the fashion which in that day prevailed among serving men and prentices. Footnote. Christ's hospital costume. it is most reasonable to regard the dress as copied from the costume of the citizens of London of that period, when long blue coats were the common habit of apprentices and serving-men, and yellow stockings were generally worn. The coat fits closely to the body, but has loose sleeves, and beneath is worn a sleeveless yellow undercoat. Around the waist is a red leathern girdle, a clerical band round the collar, and a small flat black cap, about the size of a saucer, completes the costume. Tim's Curiosities of London. End of footnote. That is to say, each had on the crown of his head a flat black cap about the size of a saucer, which was not useful as a covering, it being of such scanty dimensions, neither was it ornamental. From beneath it the hair fell, unparted, to the middle of the forehead, and was cropped straight around, a clerical band at the neck, a blue gown that fitted closely and hung as low as the knees or lower, blue sleeves, a broad red belt, bright yellow stockings, gartered above the knees, low shoes with large metal buckles. It was a sufficiently ugly costume. The boys stopped their play and flocked about the prince, who said with native dignity, "Good lads, say to your master that Edward, Prince of Wales, desireth speech with him." A great shout went up at this, and one rude fellow said, "Marry, art thou his grace's messenger, beggar?" The prince's face flushed with anger, and his ready hand flew to his hip, but there was nothing there. There was a storm of laughter, and one boy said, "Didst mark that? He fancied he had a sword. Belike he is the prince himself." This sally brought more laughter. Poor Edward drew himself up proudly and said, "I am the prince, and it ill beseemeth you that feed upon the king my father's bounty to use me so." This was vastly enjoyed, as the laughter testified. The youth, who had first spoken, shouted to his comrades, "Ho, swine, slaves, pensioners of his grace's princely father, where be your manners? Down on your marrow-bones, all of ye, and do reverence to his kingly port and royal rags." With boisterous mirth they dropped upon their knees in a body, and did mock homage to their prey. The prince spurned the nearest boy with his foot, and said fiercely, "Take thou that, till the morrow come and I build thee a gibbet." Ah, but this was not a joke. This was going beyond fun. The laughter ceased on the instant, and fury took its place. A dozen shouted, "Hail him forth! To the horse-pond! To the horse-pond! Where be the dogs? Ho there, lion! Ho, fangs!" Then followed such a thing as England had never seen before. The sacred person of the heir to the throne, rudely buffeted by plebeian hands, and set upon and torn by dogs. As night drew to a close that day, the prince found himself far down in the close-built portion of the city. His body was bruised, his hands were bleeding, and his rags were all besmirched with mud. He wandered on and on, and grew more and more bewildered, and so tired and faint he could hardly drag one foot after the other. He had ceased to ask questions of any one, since they brought him only insult instead of information. He kept muttering to himself, "Offal Court, that is the name. If I can but find it, before my strength is wholly spent and I drop, then I am saved, for his people will take me to the palace, and prove that I am none of theirs, but the true prince, and I shall have mine own again." And now and then his mind reverted to his treatment by those rude Christ Hospital boys, and he said, "When I am king, they shall not have bread and shelter only, but also teachings out of books, for a full belly is little worth where the mind is starved, and the heart. I will keep this diligently in my remembrance, that this day's lesson be not lost upon me, and my people suffer thereby. For learning softeneth the heart, and breedeth gentleness and charity." Footnote. It appears that Christ's Hospital was not originally founded as a school. Its object was to rescue children from the streets, to shelter, feed, clothe them, etc. Tim's Curiosities of London. End of footnote. The lights began to twinkle, it came on to rain, the wind rose, and a raw and gusty night set in. The houseless prince, the homeless heir to the throne of England, still moved on, drifting deeper into the maze of squalid alleys, where the swarming hives of poverty and misery were massed together. Suddenly a great drunken ruffian collared him and said,
out to this time of night again? And hast thou brought a farthing home, I warrant me? If it be so, and I do not break all the bones in thy lean body, then am I not John Canty, but some other."
The prince twisted himself loose, unconsciously brushed his profane shoulder, and eagerly said,
"Oh, art his father, truly? Sweet heaven, grant it be so, then wilt thou fetch him away and restore me."
"His father? I know not what thou mean'st. I but know I am thy father, as thou shalt soon have cause to—"
"Oh, jest not, palter not, delay not. I am worn, I am wounded, I can bear no more. Take me to the king, my father, and he will make thee rich beyond thy wildest dreams. Believe me, man, believe me. I speak no lie, but only the truth. Put forth thy hand and save me. I am indeed the Prince of Wales."
The man stared down, stupefied, upon the lad, then shook his head and muttered,
"Gone stark mad as any Tom o' Bedlam,"
then collared him once more, and said with a coarse laugh and an oath,
"But mad or mad, I and thy grammar Canty will soon find where the soft places in thy bones lie, or I'm no true man."
With this he dragged the frantic and struggling prince away, and disappeared up a foul court, followed by a delighted and noisy swarm of human vermin. Chapter 5. Tom as a Patrician. Tom Canty, left alone in the prince's cabinet, made good use of his opportunity. He turned himself this way and that before the great mirror, admiring his finery, then walked away, imitating the prince's high-bred carriage, and still observing results in the glass. Next he drew the beautiful sword, and bowed, kissing the blade, and laying it across his breast, as he had seen a noble knight do, by way of salute, to the lieutenant of the Tower 5 or 6 weeks before, when delivering the great lords of Norfolk and Surrey into his hands for captivity. Tom played with a jeweled dagger that hung upon his thigh. He examined the costly and exquisite ornaments of the room. He tried each of the sumptuous chairs, and thought how proud he would be if the Offal Court herd could only peep in and see him in his grandeur. He wondered if they would believe the marvelous tale he should tell when he got home, or if they would shake their heads and say his overtaxed imagination had at last upset his reason. At the end of half an hour it suddenly occurred to him that the prince was gone a long time. Then right away he began to feel lonely. Very soon he fell to listening and longing, and ceased to toy with the pretty things about him. He grew uneasy, then restless, then distressed. Suppose someone should come and catch him in the prince's clothes, and the prince not there to explain. Might they not hang him at once, and inquire into his case afterward? He had heard that the great were prompt about small matters. His fears rose higher and higher, and trembling he softly opened the door to the antechamber, resolved to fly and seek the prince, and through him protection and release. 6 gorgeous gentlemen servants and 2 young pages of high degree, clothed like butterflies, sprung to their feet and bowed low before him. He stepped quickly back and shut the door. He said,
"Oh, they mock at me. They will go and tell. Oh, why came I here to cast away my life?"
He walked up and down the floor, filled with nameless fears, listening, starting at every trifling sound. Presently the door swung open, and a silken page said,
"The Lady Jane Grey."
The door closed, and a sweet young girl, richly clad, bounded toward him. But she stopped suddenly, and said in a distressed voice,
"Oh, what aileth thee, my lord?"
Tom's breath was nearly failing him, but he made shift to stammer out,
"Ah, be merciful thou! In sooth I am no lord, but only poor Tom Canty of Offal Court in the city. Prithee let me see the prince, and he will of his grace restore to me my rags, and let me hence unhurt. Oh, be thou merciful, and save me!"
By this time the boy was on his knees, and supplicating with his eyes and uplifted hands, as well as with his tongue. The young girl seemed horror-stricken. She cried out,
"Oh, my lord, on thy knees, and to me!"
Then she fled away in fright, and Tom, smitten with despair, sank down, murmuring,
"There is no help, there is no hope. Now will they come and take me."
Whilst he lay there benumbed with terror, dreadful tidings were speeding through the palace. The whisper, for it was whispered always, flew from menial to menial, from lord to lady, down all the long corridors, from story to story, from saloon to saloon,
"The prince hath gone mad! The prince hath gone mad!"
Soon every saloon, every marble hall, had its groups of glittering lords and ladies, and other groups of dazzling lesser folk, talking earnestly together in whispers, and every face had in it dismay. Presently a splendid official came marching by these groups, making solemn proclamation, "In the name of the king, let none list to this false and foolish matter upon pain of death, nor discuss the same, nor carry it abroad. In the name of the king." The whispering ceased as suddenly as if the whisperers had been stricken dumb. Soon there was a general buzz along the corridors of, "The prince! See, the prince comes!" Poor Tom came slowly walking past the low-bowing groups, trying to bow in return, and meekly gazing upon his strange surroundings with bewildered and pathetic eyes. Great nobles walked upon each side of him, making him lean upon them, and so steady his steps. Behind him followed the court physicians and some servants. Presently Tom found himself in a noble apartment of the palace, and heard the door close behind him. Around him stood those who had come with him. Before him, at a little distance, reclined a very large and very fat man, with a wide, pulpy face and a stern expression. His large head was very gray, and his whiskers, which he wore only around his face, like a frame, were gray also. His clothing was of rich stuff, but old and slightly frayed in places. One of his swollen legs had a pillow under it and was wrapped in bandages. There was silence now, and there was no head there, but was bent in reverence, except this man's. This stern-countenanced invalid was the dread Henry VIII. He said, and his face grew gentle as he began to speak,
"How now, my lord Edward, my prince? Hast been minded to cousin me, the good king thy father, who loveth thee and kindly useth thee, with a sorry jest?"
Poor Tom was listening as well as his dazed faculties would let him to the beginning of this speech, but when the words, "me, the good king," fell upon his ear, his face blanched, and he dropped as instantly upon his knees as if a shot had brought him there. Lifting up his hands, he exclaimed,
"Thou, the king? Then am I undone indeed!"
This speech seemed to stun the king. His eyes wandered from face to face aimlessly, then rested bewildered upon the boy before him. Then he said in a tone of deep disappointment,
"Alack, I had believed the rumor disproportioned to the truth, but I fear me 'tis not so."
He breathed a heavy sigh, and said in a gentle voice, "Come to thy father, child. Thou art not well." Tom was assisted to his feet, and approached the Majesty of England, humble and trembling. The king took the frightened face between his hands, and gazed earnestly and lovingly into it a while, as if seeking some grateful sign of returning reason there, then pressed the curly head against his breast and patted it tenderly. Presently he said,
"Dost not know thy father, child? Break not mine old heart. Say thou knowest me. Thou dost know me, dost thou not? Yea, thou art my dread lord the king, whom God preserve. True, true, that is well. Be comforted. Tremble not so. There is none here would hurt thee. There is none here but loves thee. Thou art better now. Thy ill dream passeth. Is't not so? And thou knowest thyself now also. Is't not so? Thou wilt not miscall thyself again, as they say thou didst a little while agone. I pray thee of thy grace believe me. I did but speak the truth, most dread lord, for I am the meanest among thy subjects, being a pauper born. And 'tis by a sore mischance and accident I am here, albeit I was therein nothing blameful. I am but young to die, and thou canst save me with one little word. Oh, speak it, sir."
"Die? Talk not so, sweet prince. Peace, peace to thy troubled heart. Thou shalt not die." Tom dropped upon his knees with a glad cry.
"God requite thy mercy, O my king, and save thee long to bless thy land."
Then, springing up, he turned a joyful face toward the two lords-in-waiting, and exclaimed,
"Thou heardst it! I am not to die! The king hath said it!"
There was no movement, save that all bowed with grave respect, but no one spoke. He hesitated, a little confused, then turned timidly toward the king, saying,
"I may go now?"
"Go? Surely, if thou desireth.
But why not tarry yet a little? Whither wouldst go?"
Tom dropped his eyes and answered humbly,
Peradventure I mistook, but I did think me free, and so was I moved to seek again in the kennel where I was born and bred to misery, yet which harboureth my mother and my sisters, and so is home to me, whereas these pomps and splendours whereunto I am not used. Oh, please you, sir, to let me go."
The king was silent and thoughtful a while, and his face betrayed a growing distress and uneasiness. Presently he said, with something of hope in his voice,
"Perchance he is but mad upon this one strain, and hath his wits unmarred as toucheth other matters. God send it may be so. We will make trial."
Then he asked Tom a question in Latin, and Tom answered him lamely in the same tongue. The king was delighted, and showed it. The lords and doctors manifested their gratification also. The king said,
"'Twas not according to his schooling and ability, but showeth that his mind is but diseased, not stricken fatally. How say you, sir?"
The physician addressed bowed low, and replied,
"It jumpeth with mine own conviction, sire, that thou hast divined aright."
The king looked pleased with this encouragement, coming as it did from so excellent authority, and continued with good heart,
"Now, mark ye all, we will try him further."
He put a question to Tom in French. Tom stood silent a moment, embarrassed by having so many eyes centered upon him, then said diffidently,
"I have no knowledge of this tongue, so please your majesty."
The king fell back upon his couch. The attendants flew to his assistance, but he put them aside and said,
"Trouble me not. It is nothing but a scurvy faintness. Raise me. There, 'tis sufficient. Come hither, child. There, rest thy poor troubled head upon thy father's heart, and be at peace. Thou'lt soon be well. 'Tis but a passing fantasy. Fear thou not. Thou'lt soon be well."
Then he turned toward the company. His gentle manner changed, and baleful lightnings began to play from his eyes. He said,
"List ye all! This my son is mad, but it is not permanent. Overstudy hath done this, and somewhat too much of confinement. Away with his books and teachers, see ye to it. Pleasure him with sports, beguile him in wholesome ways, so that his health come again."
He raised himself higher still, and went on with energy,
"He is mad, but he is my son and England's heir, and mad or sane still shall he reign. And hear ye further, and proclaim it. Whoso speaketh of his distemper worketh against the peace and order of these realms, and shall to the gallows. Give me to drink. I burn. This sorrow sappeth my strength. There, take away the cup. Support me. There, that is well. Mad is he? Were he a thousand times mad, yet is he Prince of Wales, and I, the king, will confirm it. This very morrow shall he be installed in his princely dignity, in due and ancient form. Take instant order for it, my Lord Hertford."
One of the nobles knelt at the royal couch and said,
"The king's majesty knoweth that the hereditary great marshal of England lieth attained in the tower. It were not meet that one attained—"
"Peace! Insult not mine ears with his hated name. Is this man to live forever? Am I to be balked of my will? Is the prince to tarry uninstalled, because, forsooth, the realm lacketh an earl marshal free of treasonable taint, to invest him with his honours? No, by the splendour of God! Warn my parliament to bring me Norfolk's doom before the sun rise again, else shall they answer for it grievously."
[Footnote: The Duke of Norfolk's condemnation commanded. The king was now approaching fast towards his end, and fearing lest Norfolk should escape him, he sent a message to the Commons, by which he desired them to hasten the bill, on pretense that Norfolk enjoyed the dignity of Earl Marshal, and it was necessary to appoint another, who might officiate at the ensuing ceremony of installing his son, Prince of Wales. Hume's History of England, Volume 3, page 307. End of footnote. Lord Hertford said,
"The king's will is law,"
and rising, returned to his former place. Gradually the wrath faded out of the old king's face, and he said,
"Kiss me, my prince. There, what fearest thou? Am I not thy loving father?"
Thou art good to me, that am unworthy, O mighty and gracious Lord, that in truth I know, but it grieveth me to think of him that is to die, and—
Ah, 'tis like thee, 'tis like thee. I know thy heart is still the same, even though thy mind hath suffered hurt, for thou wert ever of a gentle spirit. But this duke standeth between thee and thine honours. I will have another in his stead, that shall bring no taint to his great office. Comfort thee, my prince. Trouble not thy poor head with this matter.
But is it not I that speed him hence, my liege? How long might he not live but for me?
Take no thought of him, my prince. He is not worthy. Kiss me once again, and go to thy trifles and amusements, for my malady distresseth me. I am aweary, and would rest. Go with thine uncle Hertford and thy people, and come again when my body is refreshed. Tom, heavy-hearted, was conducted from the presence, for this last sentence was a death-blow to the hope he had cherished that now he would be set free. Once more he heard the buzz of low voices exclaiming, "The prince! The prince comes!" His spirits sank lower and lower as he moved between the glittering files of bowing courtiers, for he recognized that he was indeed a captive now, and might remain forever shut up in this gilded cage, a forlorn and friendless prince, except God in his mercy take pity on him and set him free. And turn where he would, he seemed to see, floating in the air, the severed head and the remembered face of the great Duke of Norfolk, the eyes fixed on him reproachfully. His old dreams had been so pleasant, but this reality was so dreary. End of chapter 5.
Chapter 6. Tom Receives Instructions. Tom was conducted to the principal apartment of a noble suite, and made to sit down, a thing which he was loath to do, since there were elderly men and men of high degree about him. He begged them to be seated also, but they only bowed their thanks or murmured them, and remained standing. He would have insisted, but his uncle, the Earl of Hertford, whispered in his ear, "Prithee, insist not, my lord. It is not meet that they sit in thy presence." The Lord St. John was announced, and after making obeisance to Tom, he said, "I come upon the king's errand, concerning a matter which requireth privacy. Will it please your royal highness to dismiss all that attend you here, save my lord the Earl of Hertford?" Observing that Tom did not seem to know how to proceed, Hertford whispered him to make a sign with his hand, and not trouble himself to speak unless he chose. When the waiting gentleman had retired, Lord St. John said, "His Majesty commandeth that for due and weighty reasons of state, the prince's grace shall hide his infirmity in all ways that be within his power, till it be past, and he be as he was before, to wit, that he shall deny to none that he is the true prince, and heir to England's greatness, that he shall uphold his princely dignity, and shall receive, without word or sign of protest, that reverence and observance which unto it do appertain of right and ancient usage, that he shall cease to speak to any of that lowly birth and life his malady hath conjured out of the unwholesome imaginings of o'er-wrought fancy, that he shall strive with diligence to bring unto his memory again those faces which he was wont to know, and where he faileth he shall hold his peace, neither betraying by semblance of surprise or other sign that he hath forgot. That upon occasions of state, whensoever any matter shall perplex him as to the thing he should do or the utterance he should make, he shall show naught of unrest to the curious that look on, but take advice in that manner of the Lord Hertford or my humble self, which are commanded of the king to be upon this service and close at call, till this commandment be dissolved. Thus saith the king's majesty, who sendeth greeting to your royal highness, and prayeth that God will of his mercy quickly heal you, and have you now and ever in his holy keeping." The Lord St. John made reverence and stood aside. Tom replied resignedly,
"The king hath said it. None may palter with the king's command, or fit it to his ease, where it doth chafe, with deft evasions. The king shall be obeyed."
Lord Hertford said, touching the King's Majesty's ordainment concerning books and such like serious matters, it may peradventure please your highness to ease your time with lightsome entertainment, lest you go wearied to the banquet and suffer harm thereby."
Tom's face showed inquiring surprise, and a blush followed when he saw Lord St. John's eyes bent sorrowfully upon him. His lordship said,
"Thy memory still wrongeth thee, and thou hast shown surprise, but suffer it not to trouble thee, for 'tis a matter that will not bide, but depart with thy mending malady. My lord of Hertford speaketh of the city's banquet, which the King's Majesty did promise, some 2 months flown. Your highness should attend. Thou recallest it now?"
"It grieves me to confess it had indeed escaped me," said Tom, in a hesitating voice, and blushed again.
At this moment the Lady Elizabeth and the Lady Jane Grey were announced. The two lords exchanged significant glances, and Hertford stepped quickly toward the door. As the young girls passed him, he said in a low voice, "I pray thee, ladies, seem not to observe his humours, nor show surprise when his memory doth lapse. It will grieve you to note how it doth stick at every trifle." Meantime Lord St. John was saying in Tom's ear,
"Please you, sir, keep diligently in mind his Majesty's desire. Remember all thou canst, seem to remember all else. Let them not perceive that thou art much changed from thy wont, for thou knowest how tenderly thy old playfellows bear thee in their hearts, and how 'twould grieve them. Art willing, sir, that I remain, and thine uncle?"
Tom signified assent with a gesture and a murmured word, for he was already learning, and in his simple heart was resolved to acquit himself as best he might, according to the King's command. In spite of every precaution, the conversation among the young people became a little embarrassing at times. More than once, in truth, Tom was near to breaking down and confessing himself unequal to his tremendous part, but the tact of the Princess Elizabeth saved him, or a word from one or the other of the vigilant lords, thrown in apparently by chance, had the same happy effect. Once the little Lady Jane turned to Tom and dismayed him with this question,
"Hast paid thy duty to the Queen's Majesty to-day, my lord?"
Tom hesitated, looked distressed, and was about to stammer out something at hazard, when Lord St. John took the word, and answered for him with the easy grace of a courtier accustomed to encounter delicate difficulties, and to be ready for them.
"He hath indeed, madam, and she did greatly hearten him, as touching his Majesty's condition. Is it not so, your highness?"
Tom mumbled something that stood for assent, but felt that he was getting upon dangerous ground. Somewhat later it was mentioned that Tom was to study no more at present, whereupon her little ladyship exclaimed,
"'Tis a pity, 'tis such a pity! Thou wert proceeding bravely. But by thy time and patience it will not be for long. Thou'lt yet be graced with learning like thy father, and make thy tongue master of as many languages as his, good my prince."
"My father!" cried Tom, off his guard for the moment. "I trow he cannot speak his own, so that any but the swine that wallow in the styes may tell his meaning, and as for learning of any sort soever—"
He looked up and encountered a solemn warning in my lord St. John's eyes. He stopped, blushed, then continued low and steady,
"Ah, my malady persecuteth me again, and my mind wandereth. I meant the King's grace no irreverence."
"We know it, sir,"
said the Princess Elizabeth, taking her brother's hand between her two palms, respectfully but caressingly.
"Trouble not thyself as to that.
The fault is none of thine, but thy distempers." "Thou'rt a gentle comforter, sweet lady," said Tom gratefully, "and my heart moveth me to thank thee for't, and I may be so bold."
Once the giddy little Lady Jane fired a simple Greek phrase at Tom. The Princess Elizabeth's quick eye saw by the serene blankness of the target's front that the shaft was overshot, so she tranquilly delivered a return volley of sounding Greek on Tom's behalf, and then straightway changed the talk to other matters. Time wore on pleasantly, and likewise smoothly on the whole. Snags and sandbars grew less and less frequent, and Tom grew more and more at his ease, seeing that all were so lovingly bent upon helping him and overlooking his mistakes. When it came out that the little ladies were to accompany him to the Lord Mayor's banquet in the evening, his heart gave a bound of relief and delight, for he felt that he should not be friendless now among that multitude of strangers, whereas an hour earlier the idea of their going with him would have been insufferable terror to him. Tom's guardian angels, the two lords,
had had less comfort in the interview than the other parties to it, they felt much as if they were piloting a great ship through a dangerous channel. They were on the alert constantly, and found their office no child's play. Wherefore, at last, when the ladies' visit was drawing to a close and the Lord Guildford Dudley was announced, they not only felt that their charge had been sufficiently taxed for the present, but also that they themselves were not in the best condition to take their ship back and make that anxious voyage all over again. So they respectfully advised Tom to excuse himself, which he was very glad to do, although a slight shade of disappointment might have been observed upon my Lady Jane's face when she heard the splendid stripling denied admittance. There was a pause now, a sort of waiting silence which Tom could not understand. He glanced at Lord Hertford, who gave him a sign, but he failed to understand that also. The ready Elizabeth came to the rescue with her usual easy grace. She made reverence and said, "Have we leave of the Prince's Grace, my brother, to go?" Tom said, "Indeed, your ladyships can have whatsoever of me they will for the asking. Yet would I rather give them any other thing than in my poor power lieth, than leave to take the light and blessing of their presence hence. Give ye good, then, and God be with ye." Then he smiled inwardly at the thought. "'Tis not for naught I have dwelt among princes in my reading, and taught my tongue some slight trick of their broidered and gracious speech withal." When the illustrious maidens were gone, Tom turned wearily to his keepers and said, "May it please your lordships to grant me leave to go into some corner and rest me?" Lord Hertford said, "So please your highness, it is for you to command, it is for us to obey. That thou shouldst rest is indeed a needful thing, since thou must journey to the city presently." He touched a bell, and a page appeared, who was ordered to desire the presence of Sir William Herbert. This gentleman came straightway, and conducted Tom to an inner apartment. Tom's first movement there was to reach for a cup of water, but a silk and velvet servitor seized it, dropped upon one knee, and offered it to him on a golden salver. Next the tired captive sat down, and was going to take off his buskins, timidly asking leave with his eye, but another silk and velvet discomforter went down upon his knees and took the office from him. He made two or three further efforts to help himself, but being promptly forestalled each time, he finally gave up, with a sigh of resignation, and a murmured, "Beshrew me, but I marvel they do not require to breathe for me also!" Slippered and wrapped in a sumptuous robe, he laid himself down at last to rest, but not to sleep, for his head was too full of thoughts and the room too full of people. He could not dismiss the former, so they stayed. He did not know enough to dismiss the latter, so they stayed also, to his vast regret, and theirs. Tom's departure had left his two noble guardians alone. They mused a while, with much head-shaking and walking the floor. Then Lord St. John said, "Plainly, what dost thou think?" "Plainly, then, this. The king is near his end. My nephew is mad. Mad will mount the throne, and mad remain. God protect England, since she will need it."
"Verily, it promises so, indeed. But have you no misgivings as to...
The speaker hesitated and finally stopped. He evidently felt that he was upon delicate ground. Lord Hertford stopped before him, looked into his face with a clear, frank eye, and said,
"Speak on. There is none to hear but me. Misgivings as to what?" "I am full loath to word the thing that is in my mind, and thou so near to him in blood, my lord. But craving pardon if I do offend, seemeth it not strange that madness could so change his port and manner? Not but that his port and speech are princely still, but that they differ, in one unweighty trifle or another, from what his custom was aforetime. Seemeth it not strange that madness should filch from his memory his father's very lineaments, the customs and observances that are his due from such as be about him, and, leaving him his Latin, strip him of his Greek and French? My lord, be not offended, but ease my mind of its disquiet, and receive my grateful thanks. It haunteth me, his saying he was not the prince, and so—"
"Peace, my lord, thou utterest treason. Hast forgot the king's command? Remember, I am party to thy crime, if I but listen."
So St. John paled, and hastened to say, "I was in fault, I do confess it. Betray me not. Grant me this grace out of thy courtesy. I will neither think nor speak of this thing more. Deal not hardly with me, sir, else am I ruined."
"I am content, my lord. So thou offend not again, here or in the ear of others, it shall be as though thou hadst not spoken. But thou needst not have misgivings. He is my sister's son. Are not his voice, his face, his form, familiar to me from his cradle? Madness can do all the odd conflicting things thou seest in him, and more. Dost not recall how that the old Baron Marley, being mad, forgot the favour of his own countenance that he had known for 60 years, and held it was another's? Nay, even claimed he was the son of Mary Magdalene, and that his head was made of Spanish glass, and, sooth to say, he suffered none to touch it, lest by mischance some heedless hand might shiver it. Give thy misgivings easement, good my lord. This is the very prince, I know him well, and soon will be thy king. It may advantage thee to bear this in mind, and more dwell upon it than the other." After some further talk, in which the Lord St. John covered up his mistake as well as he could by repeated protests that his faith was thoroughly grounded now, and could not be assailed by doubts again, the Lord Hertford relieved his fellow-keeper and sat down to keep watch and ward alone. He was soon deep in meditation, and evidently the longer he thought, the more he was bothered. By and by he began to pace the floor and mutter, "Tush, he must be the prince. Will any he in all the land maintain there can be two, not of one blood and birth, so marvellously twinned? And even were it so, 'twere yet a stranger miracle that chance should cast the one into the other's place. Nay, 'tis folly, folly, folly!" Presently he said, "Now, were he impostor and called himself prince, look you, that would be natural, that would be reasonable. But lived ever an impostor yet who, being called prince by the king, prince by the court, prince by all, denied his dignity and pleaded against his exaltation? No, by the soul of Saint Swithin, no. This is the true prince gone mad." End of chapter 6.
Chapter 7. Tom's First Royal Dinner. Somewhat after 1 in the afternoon, Tom resignedly underwent the ordeal of being dressed for dinner. He found himself as finely clothed as before, but everything was different, everything changed, from his ruff to his stockings. He was presently conducted with much state to a spacious and ornate apartment, where a table was already set for 1. Its furniture was all of massy gold, and beautified with designs which well-nigh made it priceless, since they were the work of Benvenuto. The room was half filled with noble servitors. A chaplain said grace, and Tom was about to fall to, for hunger had long been constitutional with him, but was interrupted by my lord the Earl of Berkeley, who fastened a napkin about his neck, for the great post of diaperers to the princes of Wales was hereditary in this nobleman's family. Tom's cup-bearer was present, and forestalled all his attempts to help himself to wine. The taster to His Highness the Prince of Wales was there also, prepared to taste any suspicious dish upon requirement, and run the risk of being poisoned. He was only an ornamental appendage at this time, and was seldom called upon to exercise his function. But there had been times, not many generations past, when the office of taster had its perils, and was not a grandeur to be desired. Why, they did not use a dog or a plumber seems strange, but all the ways of royalty are strange. My Lord Darcy, first groom of the chamber, was there, to do goodness knows what, but there he was, let that suffice. The Lord Chief Butler was there, and stood behind Tom's chair, overseeing the solemnities, under command of the Lord Great Steward and the Lord Head Cook, who stood near. Tom had 384 servants beside these, but they were not all in that room, of course, nor the quarter of them, neither was Tom aware yet that they existed. All those that were present had been well drilled, within the hour, to remember that the prince was temporarily out of his head, and to be careful to show no surprise at his vagaries, These vagaries were soon on exhibition before them, but they only moved their compassion and their sorrow, not their mirth. It was a heavy affliction to them to see the beloved prince so stricken. Poor Tom ate with his fingers mainly, but no one smiled at it, or even seemed to observe it. He inspected his napkin curiously and with deep interest, for it was of a very dainty and beautiful fabric, then said, with simplicity,
"Prithee, take it away, lest in mine unheedfulness it be soiled."
The hereditary diaper took it away with reverent manner and without word to protest of any sort. Tom examined the turnips and the lettuce with interest, and asked what they were, and if they were to be eaten, for it was only recently that men had begun to raise these things in England, in place of importing them as luxuries from Holland. Footnote. It was not till the end of this reign, Henry VIII, that any salads, carrots, turnips, or other edible roots were produced in England. The little of these vegetables that was used was formerly imported from Holland and Flanders. Queen Catherine, when she wanted a salad, was obliged to dispatch a messenger thither on purpose. Hume's History of England, Volume 3, page 314. End of footnote. His question was answered with grave respect and no surprise manifested. When he had finished his dessert, he filled his pockets with nuts, but nobody appeared to be aware of it or disturbed by it. But the next moment he was himself disturbed by it and showed discomposure, for this was the only service he had been permitted to do with his own hands during the meal, and he did not doubt that he had done a most improper and unprincely thing. At that moment the muscles of his nose began to twitch, and the end of that organ to lift and wrinkle. This continued, and Tom began to evince a growing distress. He looked appealingly, first at one and then another of the lords about him, and tears came into his eyes. They sprang forward with dismay in their faces, and begged to know his trouble. Tom said with genuine anguish,
"I crave your indulgence. My nose itcheth cruelly. What is the custom and usage in this emergence? Prithee speed, for 'tis but a little time that I can bear it."
None smiled, but all were sore perplexed, and looked one to the other in deep tribulation for counsel. But behold, here was a dead wall, and nothing in English history to tell how to get over it. The master of ceremonies was not present. There was no one who felt safe to venture upon this uncharted sea, or risk the attempt to solve this solemn problem. Alas, there was no hereditary scratcher. Meantime the tears had overflowed their banks and begun to trickle down Tom's cheeks. His twitching nose was pleading more urgently than ever for relief. At last nature broke down the barriers of etiquette. Tom lifted up an inward prayer for pardon if he was doing wrong, and brought relief to the burdened hearts of his court by scratching his nose himself. His meal being ended, a lord came and held before him a broad, shallow, golden dish with fragrant rose-water in it, to cleanse his mouth and fingers with, and my lord the hereditary diaper stood by with a napkin for his use. Tom gazed at the dish a puzzled moment or two, then raised it to his lips and gravely took a draught. Then he returned it to the waiting lord and said,
"Nay, it likes me not, my lord. It hath a pretty flavour, but it wanteth strength."
This new eccentricity of the prince's ruined mind made all the hearts about him ache, but the sad sight moved none to merriment. Tom's next unconscious blunder was to get up and leave the table just when the chaplain had taken his stand behind his chair, and with uplifted hands and closed uplifted eyes was in the act of beginning the blessing. Still nobody seemed to perceive that the prince had done a thing unusual. By his own request, our small friend was now conducted to his private cabinet, and left there alone to his own devices. Hanging upon hooks in the oaken wainscoting were the several pieces of a suit of shining steel armor, covered all over with beautiful designs, exquisitely inlaid in gold. This martial panoply belonged to the true prince, a recent present from Madame Parr, the queen. Tom put on the greaves, the gauntlets, the plumed helmet, and such other pieces as he could don without assistance, and for a while was minded to call for help and complete the matter, but bethought him of the nuts he had brought away from dinner, and the joy it would be to eat them with no crowd to eye him, and no grand hereditaries to pester him with undesired services. So he restored the pretty things to their several places, and soon was cracking nuts and feeling almost naturally happy, for the first time since God for his sins had made him a prince. When the nuts were all gone, he stumbled upon some inviting books in a closet, among them one about the etiquette of the English court. This was a prize. He lay down upon a sumptuous divan, and proceeded to instruct himself with honest zeal. Let us leave him there for the present. End of chapter 7. Chapter 8. The Question of the Seal. About 5 o'clock, Henry VIII awoke out of an unrefreshing nap and muttered to himself, "Troublous dreams, troublous dreams! Mine end is now at hand. So say these warnings, and my failing pulses do confirm it." Presently a wicked light flamed up in his eye, and he muttered, "Yet will not I die till he go before." His attendants, perceiving that he was awake, one of them asked his pleasure concerning the Lord Chancellor, who was waiting without. "Admit him! Admit him!" exclaimed the King eagerly. The Lord Chancellor entered and knelt by the King's couch, saying, "I have given order, and according to the King's command, the peers of the realm in their robes do now stand at the bar of the House, where, having confirmed the Duke of Norfolk's doom, they humbly wait His Majesty's further pleasure in the matter." The King's face lit up with a fierce joy. Said he, "Lift me up! In mine own person will I go before my Parliament, and with mine own hand will I seal the warrant that rids me of—" His voice failed. An ashen pallor swept the flush from his cheeks, and the attendants eased him back upon his pillows and hurriedly assisted him with restoratives. Presently he said sorrowfully, "Alack, how have I longed for this sweet hour! And lo! Too late it cometh, and I am robbed of this so coveted chance. But speed ye, let others do this happy office, sith 'tis denied to me. I put my great seal in commission. Choose thou the lords that shall compose it, and get ye to your work. Speed ye, man, before the sun shall rise and set again, bring me his head that I may see it."
"According to the King's command, so shall it be. Will't please your Majesty to order that the seal be now restored to me, so that I may forth upon the business?"
"The seal! Who keepeth the seal but thou?"
"Please your Majesty, you did take it from me 2 days since, saying it should no more do its office till your own royal hand should use it upon the Duke of Norfolk's warrant."
"Why, so in sooth I did. I do remember it. What did I with it? I am very feeble. So oft these days doth my memory play the traitor with me. 'Tis strange, strange."
The King dropped into inarticulate mumblings, shaking his gray head weakly from time to time, and gropingly trying to recollect what he had done with the seal. At last my Lord Hertford ventured to kneel and offer information.
"Sire, if that I may be so bold, here be several that do remember, with me, how that you gave the great seal into the hands of His Highness the Prince of Wales, to keep against the day that—"
"True, true, most true," interrupted the King. "Fetch it. Go, time flieth."
Lord Hertford flew to Tom, but returned to the King before very long, troubled and empty-handed. He delivered himself to this effect:
"It grieveth me, my lord King, to bear so heavy and unwelcome tidings, but it is the will of God that the prince's affliction abideth still, and he cannot recall to mind that he received the seal. So came I quickly to report, thinking it were waste of precious time, and little worth withal, that any should attempt to search the long array of chambers and saloons that belong unto his royal high—" A groan from the King interrupted my lord at this point. After a little while His Majesty said, with a deep sadness in his tone,
"Trouble him no more, poor child. The hand of God lieth heavy upon him, and my heart goeth out in loving compassion for him, and sorrow that I may not bear his burden on mine own old trouble-weighted shoulders, and so bring him peace."
He closed his eyes, fell to mumbling, and presently was silent. After a time he opened his eyes again, and gazed vacantly around until his glance rested upon the kneeling Lord Chancellor. Instantly his face flushed with wrath.
"What, thou here yet? By the glory of God, and thou gettest not about that traitor's business, thy mitre shall have holiday the morrow, for lack of a head to grace withal."
The trembling Chancellor answered,
"Good, your Majesty, I cry you mercy. I but waited for the seal.
Man, hast lost thy wits? The small seal which aforetime I was wont to take with me abroad lieth in my treasury, and since the great seal hath flown away, shall not it suffice? Hast lost thy wits? Begone, and harkee, come no more till thou do bring his head."
The poor Chancellor was not long in removing himself from this dangerous vicinity, nor did the Commission waste time in giving the royal assent to the work of the slavish Parliament, and appointing the morrow for the beheading of the Premier Peer of England, the luckless Duke of Norfolk. Footnote. Attainder of Norfolk. The House of Peers, without examining the prisoner, without trial or evidence, passed a bill of attainder against him and sent it down to the Commons. The obsequious Commons obeyed his, the King's, directions, and the King, having affixed the royal assent to the bill by commissioners, issued orders for the execution of Norfolk on the morning of the 29th of January, the next day. Hume's History of England, Volume 3, page 307. End of footnote. End of Chapter 8. Chapter 9. The River Pageant. At 9 in the evening, the whole vast river-front of the palace was blazing with light. The river itself, as far as the eye could reach citywards, was so thickly covered with watermen's boats and with pleasure-barges, all fringed with colored lanterns and gently agitated by the waves, that it resembled a glowing and limitless garden of flowers, stirred to soft motion by summer winds. The grand terrace of stone steps leading down to the water, spacious enough to mass the army of a German principality upon, was a picture to see, with its ranks of royal halberdiers in polished armor and its troops of brilliantly costumed servitors flitting up and down and to and fro in the hurry of preparation. Presently a command was given, and immediately all living creatures vanished from the steps. Now the air was heavy with the hush of suspense and expectancy. As far as one's vision could carry, he might see the myriads of people in the boats rise up and shade their eyes from the glare of lanterns and torches, and gaze toward the palace. A file of 40 or 50 state barges drew up to the steps. They were richly gilt, and their lofty prows and sterns were elaborately carved. Some of them were decorated with banners and streamers, some with cloth of gold and arras, embroidered with coats of arms, others with silken flags that had numberless little silver bells fastened to them, which shook out tiny showers of joyous music whenever the breezes fluttered them. Others, of yet higher pretensions, since they belonged to nobles in the prince's immediate service, had their sides picturesquely fenced with shields gorgeously emblazoned with armorial bearings. Each state barge was towed by a tender. Besides the rowers, these tenders carried each a number of men-at-arms in glossy helmet and breastplate, and a company of musicians. The advance guard of the expected procession now appeared in the great gateway, a troop of halberdiers. They were dressed in striped hose of black and tawny, velvet caps graced at the sides with silver roses, and doublets of murrey and blue cloth embroidered on the front and back with the three feathers, the prince's blazon, woven in gold. Their halberd staves were covered with crimson velvet, fastened with gilt nails and ornamented with gold tassels. Filing off to the right and left, they formed two long lines extending from the gateway of the palace to the water's edge. A thick rayed cloth or carpet was then unfolded and laid down between them by attendants in the gold and crimson liveries of the prince. This done, a flourish of trumpets resounded from within, a lively prelude arose from the musicians on the water, and two ushers with white wands marched with a slow and stately pace from the portal. They were followed by an officer bearing the civic mace, after whom came another carrying the city's sword, then several sergeants of the guard, in their full accoutrements and with badges on their sleeves, then the garter king-at-arms in his tabard, then several knights of the bath, each with a white lace on his sleeve, then their esquires, then the judges in their robes of scarlet and coifs, then the Lord High Chancellor of England in a robe of scarlet, open before and purfled with miniver, then a deputation of aldermen in their scarlet cloaks, and then the heads of the different civic companies in their robes of state. Now came 12 French gentlemen in splendid habiliments, consisting of pourpoints of white damask, barred with gold, short mantles of crimson velvet, lined with violet taffeta,
and carnation-colored haute de chausses, and took their way down the steps. They were of the suite of the French ambassador, and were followed by 12 cavaliers of the suite of the Spanish ambassador, clothed in black velvet, unrelieved by any ornaments. Following these came several great English nobles with their attendants. There was a flourish of trumpets within, and the prince's uncle, the future great Duke of Somerset, emerged from the gateway, arrayed in a doublet of black cloth of gold, and a cloak of crimson satin flowered with gold and ribboned with nets of silver. He turned, doffed his plumed cap, bent his body in a low reverence, and began to step backward, bowing at each step. A prolonged trumpet blast followed, and a proclamation, "Way for the high and mighty, the Lord Edward, Prince of Wales!" High aloft, on the palace walls, a long line of red tongues of flame leapt forth, with a thunder crash. The mast whirled on the river, burst into a mighty roar of welcome, and Tom Canty, the cause and hero of it all, stepped into view and slightly bowed his princely head. He was magnificently habited in a doublet of white satin with a frontpiece of purple cloth of tissue, powdered with diamonds and edged with ermine. Over this he wore a mantle of white cloth of gold, pounced with triple feather crest, lined with blue satin, set with pearls and precious stones, and fastened with a clasp of brilliants. About his neck hung the Order of the Garter and several princely foreign orders, and wherever the light fell upon him, jewels responded with a blinding flash. Oh, Tom Canty, born in a hovel, bred in the gutters of London, familiar with rags and dirt and misery, what a spectacle is this! End of Chapter 9. Chapter 10. The Prince in the Toils. We left John Canty dragging the rightful prince into Offal Court, with a noisy and delighted mob at his heels. There was but one person in it who offered a pleading word for the captive, and he was not heeded. He was hardly even heard, so great was the turmoil. The prince continued to struggle for freedom and to rage against the treatment he was suffering, until John Canty lost what little patience was left him, and raised his oaken cudgel in a sudden fury over the prince's head. The single pleader for the lad sprang to stop the man's arm, and the blow descended upon his own wrist. Canty roared out, "Thou'lt meddle, wilt thou? Then have thy reward!" His cudgel crashed down upon the meddler's head. There was a groan, a dim form sank to the ground among the feet of the crowd, and the next moment it lay there in the dark, alone. The mob pressed on, their enjoyment nothing disturbed by this episode. Presently the prince found himself in John Canty's abode, with the door closed against the outsiders. By the vague light of a tallow candle which was thrust into a bottle, he made out the main features of the loathsome den, and also the occupants of it. Two frowsy girls and a middle-aged woman cowered against the wall in one corner, with the aspect of animals habituated to harsh usage and expecting and dreading it now. From another corner stole a withered hag with streaming gray hair and malignant eyes. John Canty said to this one, "Tarry, there's fine mummeries here. Mar them not till thou'st enjoy them. Then let thy hand be heavy as thou wilt. Stand forth, lad. Now say thy foolery again, and thou'st not forget it. Name thy name. Who art thou?" The insulted blood mounted to the little prince's cheek once more, and he lifted a steady and indignant gaze to the man's face and said, "'Tis but ill-breeding in such as thou to command me to speak. I tell thee now, as I told thee before, I am Edward, Prince of Wales, and none other." The stunning surprise of this reply nailed the hag's feet to the floor where she stood, and almost took her breath. She stared at the prince in stupid amazement, which so amused her ruffianly son that he burst into a roar of laughter. But the effect on Tom Canty's mother and sisters was different. Their dread of bodily injury gave way at once to distress of a different sort. They ran forward with woe and dismay in their faces, exclaiming, "Oh, poor Tom, poor lad!" The mother fell on her knees before the prince, put her hands upon his shoulders, and gazed yearningly into his face through her rising tears, and then she said, "Oh, my poor boy, thy foolish reading hath wrought its woeful work at last, and ta'en thy wit away. And why dost thou cleave to it, when I so warned thee against it? Thou'st broke thy mother's heart." The prince looked into her face, and said gently, "Thy son is well, and hath not lost his wits, good dame. Comfort thee.
Let me to the palace where he is, and straightway will the king my father restore him to thee.
The king thy father? O, my child, unsay these words that be freighted with death for thee, and ruin for all that be near to thee. Shake off this gruesome dream. Call back thy poor wandering memory. Look upon me. Am I not thy mother that bore thee and loveth thee?
The prince shook his head and reluctantly said, God knoweth I am loath to grieve thy heart, but truly have I never looked upon thy face before.
The woman sank back to a sitting posture on the floor, and covering her eyes with her hands, gave way to heartbroken sobs and wailings.
Let the show go on, shouted Canty. What, Nan? What, Bet? Mannerless wenches? Will ye stand in the prince's presence? Upon your knees, ye pauper scum, and do him reverence!
He followed this with another hoarse laugh. The girls began to plead timidly for their brother, and Nan said,
And thou wilt but let him to bed, father. Rest and sleep will heal his madness. Prithee do.
Do, father, said Bet. He is more worn than is his wont. Tomorrow will he be himself again, and will beg with diligence, and come not empty home again.
This remark sobered the father's joviality and brought his mind to business. He turned angrily upon the prince and said,
The morrow must we pay 2 pennies to him that owns this hole. 2 pennies, Marky! All this money for a half year's rent, else out of this we go. Show what thou'st gathered with thy lazy begging.
The prince said,
Offend me not with thy sordid matters. I tell thee again, I am the king's son.
A sounding blow upon the prince's shoulder from Canty's broad palm sent him staggering into Goodwife Canty's arms, who clasped him to her breast and sheltered him from a pelting rain of cuffs and slaps by interposing her own person. The frightened girls retreated to their corner, but the grandmother stepped eagerly forward to assist her son. The prince sprang away from Mrs. Canty, exclaiming,
"Thou shalt not suffer for me, madam. Let these swine do their will upon me alone."
This speech infuriated the swine to such a degree that they set about their work without waste of time. Between them they belabored the boy right soundly, and then gave the girls and their mother a beating for showing sympathy for the victim.
"Now," said Canty, "to bed, all of you! The entertainment has tired me!"
The light was put out, and the family retired. As soon as the snorings of the head of the house and his mother showed that they were asleep, the young girls crept to where the prince lay and covered him tenderly from the cold with straw and rags. And their mother crept to him also, and stroked his hair and cried over him, whispering broken words of comfort and compassion in his ear the while. She had saved a morsel for him to eat also, but the boy's pains had swept away all appetite, at least for black and tasteless crusts. He was touched by her brave and costly defense of him, and by her commiseration, and he thanked her in very noble and princely words, and begged her to go to her sleep and try to forget her sorrows. And he added that the king, his father, would not let her loyal kindness and devotion go unrewarded. This return to his madness broke her heart anew, and she strained him to her breast again and again, and then went back, drowned in tears, to her bed. As she lay thinking and mourning, the suggestion began to creep into her mind that there was an undefinable something about this boy that was lacking in Tom Canty, mad or sane. She could not describe it. She could not tell just what it was, and yet her sharp mother instinct seemed to detect it and perceive it. What if the boy were really not her son after all? Oh, absurd! She almost smiled at the idea, spite of her griefs and troubles. No matter, she found that it was an idea that would not down, but persisted in haunting her. It pursued her, it harassed her, it clung to her, and refused to be put away or ignored. At last she perceived that there was not going to be any peace for her until she should devise a test that should prove, clearly and without question, whether this lad was her son or not, and so banish these wearing and worrying doubts. Ah, yes, this was plainly the right way out of the difficulty. Therefore she set her wits to work at once to contrive that test. But it was an easier thing to propose than to accomplish. She turned over in her mind one promising test after another, but was obliged to relinquish them all. None of them were absolutely sure, absolutely perfect, and an imperfect one could not satisfy her. Evidently she was racking her head in vain. It seemed manifest that she must give the matter up. While this depressing thought was passing through her mind, her ear caught the regular breathing of the boy, and she knew he had fallen asleep. And while she listened, the measured breathing was broken by a soft, startled cry, such as one utters in a troubled dream.
This chance occurrence furnished her instantly with a plan worth all her labored tests combined. She at once set herself feverishly but noiselessly to work to relight her candle, muttering to herself, "Had I but seen him then, I should have known. Since that day, when he was little, that the powder burst in his face, he hath never been startled of a sudden out of his dreams or out of his thinkings, but he hath cast his hand before his eyes, even as he did that day, and not as others would do it, with the palm inward, but always with the palm turned outward. I have seen it 100 times, and it hath never varied nor ever failed. Yes, I shall soon know, now." By this time she had crept to the slumbering boy's side, with the candle shaded in her hand. She bent heedfully and warily over him, scarcely breathing in her suppressed excitement, and suddenly flashed the light in his face and struck the floor by his ear with her knuckles. The sleeper's eyes sprung wide open, and he cast a startled stare about him, but he made no special movement with his hands. The poor woman was smitten almost helpless with surprise and grief, but she contrived to hide her emotions and to soothe the boy to sleep again. Then she crept apart and communed miserably with herself upon the disastrous result of her experiment. She tried to believe that her Tom's madness had banished this habitual gesture of his, but she could not do it. "No," she said, "his hands are not mad. They could not unlearn so old a habit in so brief a time. Oh, this is a heavy day for me." Still, hope was as stubborn now as doubt had been before. She could not bring herself to accept the verdict of the test. She must try the thing again. The failure must have been only an accident. So she startled the boy out of his sleep a second and a third time at intervals, with the same result which had marked the first test. Then she dragged herself to bed and fell sorrowfully asleep, saying, "But I cannot give him up. Oh, no, I cannot, I cannot. He must be my boy." The poor mother's interruptions having ceased, and the prince's pains having gradually lost their power to disturb him, utter weariness at last sealed his eyes in a profound and restful sleep. Hour after hour slipped away, and still he slept like the dead. Thus 4 or 5 hours passed. Then his stupor began to lighten. Presently, while half asleep and half awake, he murmured, "Sir William!" After a moment, "Ho, Sir William Herbert! Hie thee hither, and list to the strangest dream that ever. Sir William, dost hear? Man, I did think me changed to a pauper, and— Ho, there, guards! Sir William! What? Is there no groom of the chamber in waiting? Alack, it shall go hard with—" "What aileth thee?" asked a whisper near him. "Who art thou calling?" "Sir William Herbert, who art thou?" "I? Who should I be but thy sister Nan? Oh, Tom, I had forgot. Thou'rt mad yet. Poor lad, thou'rt mad yet. Would I had never woke to know it again. But prithee master thy tongue, lest we all be beaten till we die." The startled prince sprang partly up, but a sharp reminder from his stiffened bruises brought him to himself, and he sunk back among his foul straw with a groan and the ejaculation, "Alas, it was no dream then." In a moment all the heavy sorrow and misery which sleep had banished were upon him again, and he realized that he was no longer a petted prince in a palace, with the adoring eyes of a nation upon him, but a pauper, an outcast, clothed in rags, prisoner in a den fit only for beasts, and consorting with beggars and thieves. In the midst of his grief he began to be conscious of hilarious noises and shoutings, apparently but a block or two away. The next moment there were several sharp raps at the door. John Canty ceased from snoring and said,
"Who knocketh? What wilt thou?"
A voice answered, "Know'st thou who it was thou laid thy cudgel on?"
"No, neither know I nor care."
"Belike thou'll change thy note eftsoons, and thou would save thy neck, nothing but flight away, stead thee. The man is this moment delivering up the ghost. 'Tis the priest, Father Andrew."
"God a mercy!" exclaimed Canty.
He roused his family and hoarsely commanded,
"Up with all of ye and fly, or bide where ye are and perish!"
Scarcely 5 minutes later the Canty household were in the street and flying for their lives. John Canty held the prince by the wrist and hurried him along the dark way, giving him this caution in low voice,
"Mind thy tongue, thou mad fool, and speak not our name. I will choose me a new name speedily to throw the law's dogs off the scent. Mind thy tongue, I tell ye."
He growled these words to the rest of the family,
"If it so chance that we be separated, let each make for London Bridge. Whoso findeth himself as far as the last linen draper's shop on the bridge, let him tarry there till the others be come. Then will we flee into Southwark together."
At this moment the party burst suddenly out of darkness into light, and not only into light, but into the midst of a multitude of singing, dancing, and shouting people massed together on the river's frontage. There was a line of bonfires stretching as far as one could see up and down the Thames. London Bridge was illuminated, Southwark Bridge likewise. The entire river was aglow with a flash and sheen of colored lights, and constant explosions of fireworks filled the skies with an intricate commingling of shooting splendors and a thick rain of dazzling sparks that almost turned night into day. Everywhere were crowds of revelers. All London seemed to be at large. John Canty delivered himself of a furious curse and commanded a retreat, but it was too late. He and his tribe were swallowed up in that swarming hive of humanity, and hopelessly separated from each other in an instant. We are not considering that the prince was one of his tribe. Canty still kept his grip upon him. The prince's heart was beating high with hopes of escape now. A burly waterman, considerably exalted with liquor, found himself rudely shoved by Canty in his efforts to plough through the crowd. He laid his great hand on Canty's shoulder and said,
"Nay, whither so fast, friend? Dost canker thy soul with sordid business, when all that be leal men and true make holiday?" "Mine affairs are mine own, they concern thee not," answered Canty roughly. "Take away thy hand and let me pass."
"Sith that is thy humor, thou'lt not pass till thou'st drunk to the Prince of Wales, I tell thee that," said the waterman, barring the way resolutely.
"Give me the cup, then, and make speed, make speed."
Other revelers were interested by this time. They cried out, "The loving cup! The loving cup! Make the sour knave drink the loving cup, else we feed him to the fishes!"
So a huge loving cup was brought. The waterman, grasping it by one of its handles, and with his other hand bearing up the end of an imaginary napkin, presented it in due and ancient form to Canty, who had to grasp the opposite handle with one of his hands, and take off the lid with the other, according to the ancient custom. Footnote. The loving cup. The loving cup and the peculiar ceremonies observed in drinking from it are older than English history. It is thought that both are Danish importations. As far back as knowledge goes, the loving cup has always been drunk at English banquets. Tradition explains the ceremonies in this way. In the rude ancient times, it was deemed a wise precaution to have both hands of both drinkers employed, lest while the pledger pledged his love and fidelity to the pledgee take that opportunity to slip a dirk into him. End of footnote. This left the prince hand-free for a second, of course. He wasted no time, but dived among the forest of legs about him and disappeared. In another moment he could not have been harder to find under that tossing sea of life if its billows had been the Atlantic's and he a lost sixpence. He very soon realized this fact, and straightway busied himself about his own affairs without further thought of John Canty. He quickly realized another thing, too, to wit, that a spurious Prince of Wales was being feasted by the city in his stead. He easily concluded that the pauper lad, Tom Canty, had deliberately taken advantage of his stupendous opportunity and become a usurper. Therefore there was but one course to pursue: find his way to the Guildhall, make himself known, and denounce the impostor. He also made up his mind that Tom should be allowed a reasonable time for spiritual preparation, and then be hanged, drawn and quartered, according to the law and usage of the day, in cases of high treason. End of chapter 10.
Chapter 11. At Guildhall. The royal barge, attended by its gorgeous fleet, took its stately way down the Thames through the wilderness of illuminated boats. The air was laden with music. The river banks were beruffled with joy flames. The distant city lay in a soft luminous glow from its countless invisible bonfires. Above it rose many a slender spire into the sky, encrusted with sparkling lights, wherefore in their remoteness they seemed like bejeweled lances thrust aloft. As the fleet swept along, it was greeted from the banks with a continuous hoarse roar of cheers and the ceaseless flash and boom of artillery. To Tom Canty, half buried in his silken cushions, these sounds and this spectacle were a wonder unspeakably sublime and astonishing. To his little friends at his side, the Princess Elizabeth and the Lady Jane Grey, they were nothing. Arrived at the Dowgate, the fleet was towed up the limpid Walbrook, whose channel has now been for two centuries buried out of sight under acres of buildings, to Bucklersbury, past houses and under bridges, populous with merrymakers and brilliantly lighted, and at last came to a halt in a basin where now is Barge Yard, in the center of the ancient city of London. Tom disembarked, and he and his gallant procession crossed Cheapside and made a short march through the Old Jewry and Bassinghall Street to the Guildhall. Tom and his little ladies were received with due ceremony by the Lord Mayor and the Fathers of the City, in their gold chains and scarlet robes of state, and conducted to a rich canopy of state at the head of the great hall, preceded by heralds making proclamation, and by the mace and the city sword. The lords and ladies who were to attend upon Tom and his two small friends took their places behind their chairs. At a lower table the court grandees and other guests of noble degree were seated, with the magnates of the city. The commoners took places at a multitude of tables on the main floor of the hall. From their lofty vantage ground the giants Gog and Magog, the ancient guardians of the city, contemplated the spectacle below them with eyes grown familiar to it in forgotten generations. There was a bugle blast and a proclamation, and a fat butler appeared in a high perch in the leftward wall, followed by his servitors bearing with impressive solemnity a royal baron of beef, smoking hot and ready for the knife. After grace, Tom, being instructed, rose, and the whole house with him, and drank from a portly golden loving cup with the Princess Elizabeth. From her it passed to the Lady Jane, and then traversed the general assemblage. So the banquet began. By midnight the revelry was at its height. Now came one of those picturesque spectacles so admired in that old day. A description of it is still extant in the quaint wording of a chronicler who witnessed it. Space being made, presently entered a baron and an earl apparelled after the Turkish fashion, in long robes of bodkin powdered with gold, hats on their heads of crimson velvet, with great rolls of gold, girded with two swords, called scimitars, hanging by great baudricks of gold. Next came yet another baron and another earl, in two long gowns of yellow satin, traversed with white satin, and in every bend of white was a bend of crimson satin, after the fashion of Russia, with furred hats of grey on their heads, either of them having a hatchet in their hands, and boots with pikes, points a foot long, turned up, and after them came a knight, then the Lord High Admiral, and with him five nobles, in doublets of crimson velvet, voided low on the back, and before to the canal bone, laced on the breasts with chains of silver, and over that short cloaks of crimson satin, and on their heads hats after the dancer's fashion, with pheasant's feathers in them. These were apparelled after the fashion of Prussia. The torch-bearers, which were about 100, were apparelled in crimson satin and green, like Moors, their faces black. Next came in a mummery, then the minstrels, which were disguised, danced, and the lords and ladies did wildly dance also, that it was a pleasure to behold. And while Tom, in his high seat, was gazing upon this wild dancing, lost in admiration of the dazzling commingling of kaleidoscopic colours which the whirling turmoil of gaudy figures below him presented, the ragged but real little Prince of Wales was proclaiming his rights and his wrongs, denouncing the impostor, and clamouring for admission at the gates of Guildhall. The crowd enjoyed this episode prodigiously, and pressed forward and craned their necks to see the small rioter. Presently they began to taunt him and mock at him, purposely to goad him into a higher and still more entertaining fury. Tears of mortification sprung to his eyes, but he stood his ground and defied the mob right royally. Other taunts followed, added mocking stung him, and he exclaimed, "I tell ye again, you pack of unmannerly curs, I am the Prince of Wales, and all forlorn and friendless as I be, with none to give me word of grace or help me in my need, yet will not I be driven from my ground, but will maintain it. Though thou be prince or no prince, 'tis all one. Thou beest a gallant lad, and not friendless neither. Here stand I by thy side to prove it, and mind I tell thee thou mightst have a worser friend than Miles Hendon, and yet not tire thy legs with seeking. Rest thy small jaw, my child. I talk the language of these base kennel-rats like to a very native." The speaker was a sort of Don Caesar de Bazan in dress, aspect, and bearing. He was tall, trim-built, muscular, His doublet and trunks were of rich material, but faded and threadbare, and their gold lace adornments were sadly tarnished. His ruff was rumpled and damaged, the plume in his slouched hat was broken and had a bedraggled and disreputable look. At his side he wore a long rapier in a rusty iron sheath. His swaggering carriage marked him at once as a rougher of the camp. The speech of this fantastic figure was received with an explosion of jeers and laughter. Some cried, "'Tis another prince in disguise!
Wear thy tongue, friend, belike he is dangerous. Marry, he looketh it, mark his eye. Pluck the lad from him, to the horse-pond with the cub!"
Instantly a hand was laid upon the prince under the impulse of this happy thought, as instantly the stranger's long sword was out and the meddler went to the earth under a sounding thump with the flat of it. The next moment a score of voices shouted, "Kill the dog! Kill him! Kill him!" and the mob closed in on the warrior, who backed himself against a wall and began to lay about him with his long weapon like a madman. His victims sprawled this way and that, but the mob tide poured over their prostrate forms and dashed itself against the champion with undiminished fury. His moments seemed numbered, his destruction certain, when suddenly a trumpet blast sounded, a voice shouted, "Way for the king's messenger!" And a troop of horsemen came charging down upon the mob, who fled out of harm's reach as fast as their legs could carry them. The bold stranger caught up the prince in his arms and was soon far away from danger and the multitude. Return we within the guild hall. Suddenly, high above the jubilant roar and thunder of the revel, broke the clear peal of a bugle note. There was instant silence, a deep hush. Then a single voice rose, that of the messenger from the palace, and began to pipe forth a proclamation, the whole multitude standing, listening. The closing words, solemnly pronounced, were, "The king is dead!" The great assemblage bent their heads upon their breasts with one accord, remained so, in profound silence, a few moments, then all sunk upon their knees in a body, stretched out their hands toward Tom, and a mighty shout burst forth that seemed to shake the building. "Long live the king!" Poor Tom's dazed eyes wandered abroad over this stupefying spectacle, and finally rested dreamily upon the kneeling princesses beside him a moment, then upon the Earl of Hertford. A sudden purpose dawned in his face. He said in a low tone at Lord Hertford's ear, "Answer me truly, on thy faith and honour. Uttered I here a command, the which none but a king might hold privilege and prerogative to utter. Would such commandment be obeyed, and none rise up to say me nay?"
"None, my liege, in all these realms. In thy person bides the majesty of England. Thou art the king. Thy word is law."
Tom responded in a strong, earnest voice, with great animation.
"Then shall the king's law be law of mercy from this day, and never more be law of blood. Up from thy knees and away! To the tower, and say the king decrees the Duke of Norfolk shall not die."
[Footnote: The Duke of Norfolk's narrow escape. Had Henry VIII survived a few hours longer, his order for the Duke's execution would have been carried into effect. But news being carried to the tower that the king himself had expired that night, the lieutenant deferred obeying the warrant, and it was not thought advisable by the council to begin a new reign by the death of the greatest nobleman in the kingdom, who had been condemned by a sentence so unjust and tyrannical. Hume's History of England, Volume 3, page 307. End of footnote. The words were caught up and carried eagerly from lip to lip far and wide over the hall, and as Hertford hurried from the presence, another prodigious shout burst forth.
"The reign of blood is ended! Long live Edward, King of England!"
End of chapter 11. Chapter 12. The Prince and His Deliverer. As soon as Mile Hendon and the little prince were clear of the mob, they struck down through back lanes and alleys toward the river. Their way was unobstructed until they approached London Bridge. Then they ploughed into the multitude again, Hendon keeping a fast grip upon the king's wrist. The tremendous news was already abroad, and the boy learned it from a thousand voices at once. The king is dead. The tidings struck a chill to the heart of the poor little waif, and sent a shudder through his frame. He realized the greatness of his loss, and was filled with a bitter grief, for the grim tyrant who had been such a terror to others had always been gentle with him. The tears sprung to his eyes, and blurred all objects. For an instant he felt himself the most forlorn, outcast, and forsaken of God's creatures. Then another cry shook the night with its far-reaching thunders, "Long live King Edward the Sixth!" And this made his eyes kindle, and thrilled him with pride to his fingers' ends. "Ah," he thought, "how grand and strange it seems! I am king!" Our friends threaded their way slowly through the throngs upon the bridge. This structure, which had stood for 600 years, and had been a noisy and populous thoroughfare all that time, was a curious affair, for a closely packed rank of stores and shops, with family quarters overhead, stretched along both sides of it, from one bank of the river to the other. The bridge was a sort of town to itself. It had its inn, its beer-houses, its bakeries, its haberdasheries, its food markets, its manufacturing industries, and even its church. It looked upon the two neighbors which it linked together, London and Southwark, as being well enough as suburbs, but not otherwise particularly important. It was a close corporation, so to speak. It was a narrow town, of a single street a fifth of a mile long. Its population was but a village population, and everybody in it knew all his fellow-townsmen intimately, and had known their fathers and mothers before them, and all their little family affairs into the bargain. It had its aristocracy, of course, its fine old families of butchers and bakers and what not, who had occupied the same old premises for 500 or 600 years, and knew the great history of the bridge from beginning to end, and all its strange legends, and who always talked bridgey talk, and thought bridgey thoughts, and lied in a long, level, direct, substantial, bridgey way. It was just the sort of population to be narrow and ignorant and self-conceited. Children were born on the bridge, were reared there, grew to old age, and finally died, without ever having set a foot upon any part of the world but London Bridge alone. Such people would naturally imagine that the mighty and interminable procession which moved through its streets night and day, with its confused roar of shouts and cries, its neighings and bellowings and bleatings, and its muffled thunder tramp, was the one great thing in this world, and themselves somehow the proprietors of it. And so they were, in effect. At least they could exhibit it from their windows, and did, for a consideration, whenever a returning king or hero gave it a fleeting splendor, for there was no place like it for affording a long, straight, uninterrupted view of marching columns. Men born and reared upon the bridge found life unendurably dull and inane elsewhere. History tells of one of these who left the bridge at the age of 71 and retired to the country. But he could only fret and toss in his bed. He could not go to sleep. The deep stillness was so painful, so awful, so oppressive. When he was worn out with it, at last, he fled back to his old home, a lean and haggard spectre, and fell peacefully to rest and pleasant dreams under the lulling music of the lashing waters and the boom and crash and thunder of London Bridge. In the times of which we are writing, the bridge furnished object lessons in English history for its children, namely, the livid and decaying heads of renowned men impaled upon iron spikes atop of its gateways. But we digress. Hendon's lodgings were in the little inn on the bridge. As he neared the door with his small friend, a rough voice said,
"So thou'rt come at last! Thou'll not escape again, I warrant thee! And if pounding thy bones to a pudding can teach thee somewhat, thou'lt not keep us waiting another time, mayhap."
And John Canty put out his hand to seize the boy. Miles Hendon stepped in the way and said,
"Not too fast, friend. Thou art needlessly rough, methinks. What is the lad to thee?" "If it be any business of thine to make and meddle in others' affairs, he is my son."
"'Tis a lie," cried the little king hotly.
"Boldly said, and I believe thee, whether thy small headpiece be sound or cracked, my boy. But whether this scurvy ruffian be thy father or no, 'tis all one.
he shall not have thee to beat thee and abuse, according to his threat, so thou prefer to abide with me."
"I do, I do. I know him not. I loathe him, and will die before I will go with him."
"Then 'tis settled, and there is naught more to say."
"We will see as to that,"
exclaimed John Canty, striding past Hendon to get at the boy.
"By force shall he—"
"If thou do but touch him, thou animated offal, I will spit thee like a goose," said Hendon, barring the way and laying his hand upon his sword hilt. Canty drew back. "Now, mark ye," continued Hendon, "I took this lad under my protection when a mob of such as thou would have mishandled him, mayhap killed him. Dost imagine I will desert him now to a worser fate? For whether thou art his father or no, and sooth to say I think it is a lie, a decent swift death were better for such a lad than life in such brute hands as thine. So go thy ways, and set quick about it, for I like not much bandying of words, being not over-patient in my nature." John Canty moved off, muttering threats and curses, and was swallowed from sight in the crowd. Hendon ascended three flights of stairs to his room, with his charge, after ordering a meal to be sent thither. It was a poor apartment, with a shabby bed and some odds and ends of old furniture in it, and was vaguely lighted by a couple of sickly candles. The little king dragged himself to the bed and lay down upon it, almost exhausted with hunger and fatigue. He had been on his feet a good part of a day and a night, for it was now 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning, and had eaten nothing meantime. He murmured drowsily,
"Prithee, call me when the table is spread,"
and sunk into a deep sleep immediately. A smile twinkled in Hendon's eyes, and he said to himself, "By the mass, the little beggar takes to one's quarters and usurps one's bed with as natural and easy a grace as if he owned them, with never a by your leave, or so please it you, or anything of the sort. In his diseased ravings he called himself the Prince of Wales, and bravely doth he keep up the character. Poor little friendless rat, doubtless his mind has been disordered with ill usage. Well, I will be his friend. I have saved him, and it draweth me strongly to him. Already I love the bold-tongued little rascal. How soldier-like he faced the smutty rabble, and flung back his high defiance! And what a comely, sweet and gentle face he hath, now that sleep hath conjured away his troubles and its griefs. I will teach him, I will cure his malady, yea, I will be his elder brother, and care for him, and watch over him, and whoso would shame him or do him hurt may order his shroud, for though I be burnt for it, he shall need it." He bent over the boy and contemplated him with kind and pitying interest, tapping the young cheek tenderly and smoothing back the tangled curls with his great brown hand. A slight shiver passed over the boy's form. Hendon muttered, "See now, how like a man it was to let him lie here uncovered and fill his body with deadly rheums. Now what shall I do? 'Twill wake him to take him up and put him within the bed, and he sorely needeth sleep." He looked about for extra covering, but finding none, doffed his doublet and wrapped the lad in it, saying, "I am used to nipping air and scant apparel. 'Tis little I shall mind the cold." Then walked up and down the room to keep his blood in motion, soliloquizing as before. "His injured mind persuades him he is Prince of Wales. 'Twill be odd to have a Prince of Wales still with us, now that he that was the prince is prince no more but king. For this poor mind is set upon the one fantasy, and will not reason out that now it should cast by the prince and call itself the king. If my father liveth still after these 7 years that I have heard naught from him in my foreign dungeon, he will welcome the poor lad and give him generous shelter for my sake. So will my good elder brother Arthur, my other brother Hugh, but I will crack his crown and he interfere, the fox-hearted ill-conditioned animal. Yes, thither will we fare, and straightway too." A servant entered with a smoking meal, disposed it upon a small deal table, placed the chairs, and took his departure, leaving such cheap lodgers as these to wait upon themselves. The door slammed after him, and the noise woke the boy, who sprung to a sitting posture and shot a glad glance about him. Then a grieved look came into his face, and he murmured to himself with a deep sigh, "Alack, it was but a dream. Woe is me!" Next he noticed Miles Hendon's doublet, glanced from that to Hendon, comprehended the sacrifice that had been made for him, and said gently, "Thou art good to me. Yes, thou art very good to me. Take it and put it on. I shall not need it more." Then he got up and walked to the washstand in the corner, and stood there waiting.
Hendon said in a cheery voice. "We'll have a right hearty sup and bite now, for everything is savory and smoking hot, and that and thy nap together will make thee a little man again, never fear." The boy made no answer, but bent a steady look that was filled with grave surprise, and also somewhat touched with impatience, upon the tall knight of the sword. Hendon was puzzled, and said, "What's amiss?"
"Good sir, I would wash me."
"Oh, is that all? Ask no permission of Miles Hendon, for aught thou cravest. Make thyself perfectly free here, and welcome, with all that are his belongings." Still the boy stood, and moved not. More, he tapped the floor once or twice with his small impatient foot. Hendon was wholly perplexed. Said he, "Bless us, what is it? Prithee, pour the water, and make not so many words." Hendon, suppressing a hoarse laugh, and saying to himself, "By all the saints, but this is admirable," stepped briskly forward, and did the small insolence bidding, then stood by in a sort of stupefaction until the command, "Come, the towel!" woke him sharply up. He took up a towel from under the boy's nose and handed it to him without comment. He now proceeded to comfort his own face with a wash, and while he was at it, his adopted child seated himself at the table and prepared to fall to. Hendon dispatched his ablutions with alacrity, then drew back the other chair, and was about to place himself at table when the boy said indignantly, "Forbear! Wouldst sit in the presence of the king?" This blow staggered Hendon to his foundations. He muttered to himself, "Lo, the poor thing's madness is up with the time. It hath changed with a great change that is come to the realm, and now, in fancy, is he king. Good lack! I must humour the conceit, too. There is no other way. Faith, he would order me to the tower else." And pleased with this jest, he removed the chair from the table, took his stand behind the king, and proceeded to wait upon him in the courtliest way he was capable of. While the king ate, a grateful sense of refreshment, both of body and spirit, began to steal over him. The rigor of his royal dignity relaxed a little, and with his growing contentment came a desire to talk. He said,
"I think thou callest thyself Miles Hendon, if I heard thee aright?"
"Yes, sire," Miles replied, then observed to himself, "if I must humour the poor lad's madness, I must sire him, I must majesty him, I must not go by halves, I must stick at nothing that belongeth to the part I play, else shall I play it ill, and work evil to this charitable and kindly cause." The king warmed his heart with a second glass of wine, and said,
"I would know thee, tell me thy story. Thou hast a gallant way with thee, and a noble. Art nobly born?"
"We are of the tail of the nobility, good your majesty. My father is a baronet, one of the smaller lords, by knight service." Note, he refers to the order of baronet or baronets, the baron minor, as distinct from the parliamentary barons, not, it need hardly be said, the baronets of later creation. End of note.
"Sir Richard Hendon, of Hendon Hall, by Monk's Home in Kent." "The name has escaped my memory. Go on, tell me thy story."
"'Tis not much, your majesty, yet perchance it may beguile a short half-hour for want of a better. My father, Sir Richard, is very rich, and of a most generous nature. My mother died whilst I was yet a boy. I have two brothers, Arthur, my elder, with a soul like to his father's, and Hugh, younger than I, a mean spirit, covetous, treacherous, vicious, underhanded, a reptile. Such was he from the cradle. Such was he 10 years past, when I last saw him. A ripe rascal at 19, I being 20 then, and Arthur 22. There is none other of us but the Lady Edith, my cousin. She was 16 then, beautiful, gentle, good, the daughter of an earl, the last of her race, heiress of a great fortune and a lapsed title. My father was her guardian. I loved her, and she loved me. But she was betrothed to Arthur from the cradle, and Sir Richard would not suffer the contract to be broken. Arthur loved another maid, and bade us be of good cheer and hold fast to the hope that delay and luck together would some day give success to our several causes. Hugh loved the Lady Edith's fortune, though in truth he said it was herself he loved. But then 'twas his way, alway, to say the one thing and mean the other. But he lost his arts upon the girl. He could deceive my father, but none else. My father loved him best of us all, and trusted and believed him, for he was the youngest child, and others hated him, these qualities being in all ages sufficient to win a parent's dearest love. And he had a smooth, persuasive tongue, with an admirable gift of lying. And these be qualities which do mightily assist a blind affection to cousin itself. It was wild, in truth I might go yet farther, and say very wild, though 'twas a wildness of an innocent sort, since it hurt none but me, brought shame to none, nor loss, nor had it in any taint of crime or baseness, or what might not beseem mine honourable degree. Yet did my brother Hugh turn these faults to good account, he seeing that our brother Arthur's health was but indifferent, and hoping the worst might work him profit were I swept out of the path. So, but 'twere a long tale, good my liege, and little worth the telling. Briefly, then, this brother did deftly magnify my faults, and make them crimes, ending his base work with finding a silken ladder in mine apartments, conveyed thither by his own means, and did convince my father by this, and suborned evidence of servants and others lying knaves, that I was minded to carry off my Edith and marry with her, in rank defiance of his will. 3 years of banishment from home and England might make a soldier and a man of me, my father said, and teach me some degree of wisdom. I fought out my long probation in the continental wars, tasting sumptuously of hard knocks, privation, and adventure. But in my last battle I was taken captive, and during the 7 years that have waxed and waned since then, a foreign dungeon hath harbored me. Through wit and courage I won to the free air at last, and fled thither straight, and am but just arrived, right poor in purse and raiment, and poorer still in knowledge of what these dull 7 years have wrought at Hendon Hall, its people and belongings. So please you, sir, my meagre tale is told. "Thou hast been shamefully abused," said the little king, with a flashing eye, "but I will right thee, by the cross will I. The king hath said it." Then, fired by the story of Miles' wrongs, he loosed his tongue and poured the history of his own recent misfortunes into the ears of his astonished listener. When he had finished, Miles said to himself, "Lo, what an imagination he hath! Verily, this is no common mind, else, crazed or sane, it could not weave so straight and gaudy a tale as this out of the airy nothings wherewith it hath wrought this curious romaunt. Poor ruined little head, it shall not lack friend or shelter whilst I bide with the living. He shall never leave my side. He shall be my pet, my little comrade. He shall be cured, aye, made whole and sound. Then will he make himself a name, and proud shall I be to say, 'Yes, he is mine. I took him, a homeless little ragamuffin, but I saw what was in him, and I said his name would be heard some day. Behold him, observe him. Was I right?" The king spoke in a thoughtful, measured voice. "Thou didst save me injury and shame, perchance my life, and so my crown. Such service demandeth rich reward. Name thy desire, and so it be within the compass of my royal power, it is thine." This fantastic suggestion startled Hendon out of his reverie. He was about to thank the king and put the matter aside with saying he had only done his duty and desired no reward, but a wiser thought came into his head, and he asked leave to be silent a few moments and consider the gracious offer, an idea which the king gravely approved, remarking that it was best to be not too hasty with a thing of such great import. Miles reflected during some moments, then said to himself, "Yes, this is the thing to do. By any other means it were impossible to get at. And, certes, this hour's experience has taught me 'twould be most wearing and inconvenient to continue it as it is. Yes, I will propose it. 'Twas a happy accident that I did not throw the chance away." Then he dropped upon one knee and said, "My poor service went not beyond the limit of a subject's simple duty, and therefore hath no merit. But since your Majesty is pleased to hold it worthy some reward, I take heart of grace to make petition to this effect. Near 400 years ago, as your Grace knoweth, there being ill blood betwixt John, King of England, and the King of France, it was decreed that two champions should fight together in the lists, and so settled the dispute by what is called the arbitrament of God. These two kings, and the Spanish king, being assembled to witness and judge the conflict, the French champion appeared, but so redoubtable was he that our English knights refused to measure weapons with him. So the matter, which was a weighty one, was like to go against the English monarch by default. Now in the tower lay the Lord de Courcy, the mightiest arm in England, stripped of his honors and possessions, and wasting with long captivity. Appeal was made to him. He gave assent, and came forth arrayed for battle. But no sooner did the Frenchman glimpse his huge frame and hear his famous name, but he fled away, and the French king's cause was lost. King John restored De Courcy's titles and possessions, and said, "Name thy wish, and thou shalt have it, though it cost me half my kingdom." Whereat De Courcy, kneeling, as I do now, made answer, "This, then, I ask my liege, that I and my successors may have and hold the privilege of remaining covered in the presence of the kings of England, henceforth while the throne shall last. The boon was granted, as your majesty knoweth, and there hath been no time these 400 years that that line has failed of an heir, and so, even unto this day, the head of that ancient house still weareth his hat or helm before the king's majesty, without let or hindrance, and this none other may do." Note, the lords of Kingsall, descendants of De Courcy, still enjoy this curious privilege. End of note. Invoking this precedent, in aid of my prayer, I beseech the king to grant to me but this one grace and privilege, to my more than sufficient reward, and none other, to wit, that I and my heirs for ever may sit in the presence of the majesty of England. "Rise, Sir Miles Hendon, knight," said the king gravely, giving the accolade with Hendon's sword. "Rise, and seat thyself. Thy petition is granted. Whilst England remains, and the crown continues, the privilege shall not lapse." His majesty walked apart, musing, and Hendon dropped into a chair at table, observing to himself, "'Twas a brave thought, and hath wrought me a mighty deliverance. My legs are grievously wearied, and I had not thought of that. I must have had to stand for weeks till my poor lad's wits are cured." After a little he went on, "And so I am become a knight of the kingdom of dreams and shadows, a most odd and strange position, truly, for one so matter-of-fact as I. I will not laugh. No, God forbid, for this thing which is so substanceless to me is real to him, and to me also in one way it is not a falsity, for it reflects with truth a sweet and generous spirit that is in him." After a pause, "Ah, what if he should call me by my fine title before folk? There'd be a merry contrast betwixt my glory and my raiment. But no matter. Let him call me what he will, so it please him. I shall be content." End of chapter 12.
Chapter 13. The Disappearance of the Prince. A heavy drowsiness presently fell upon the two comrades. The king said, "Remove these rags," meaning his clothing. Hendon disapparelled the boy without dissent or remark, tucked him up in bed, then glanced about the room, saying to himself ruefully, "He hath taken my bed again, as before. Marry, what shall I do?" The little king observed his perplexity, and dissipated it with a word. He said sleepily, "Thou wilt sleep athwart the door, and guard it." In a moment more he was out of his troubles, in a deep slumber. "Dear heart, he should have been born a king," muttered Hendon admiringly. "He playeth the part to a marvel." Then he stretched himself across the door on the floor, saying contentedly, "I have lodged worse for 7 years. 'Twould be but ill gratitude to him above to find fault with this." He dropped asleep as the dawn appeared. Toward noon he rose, uncovered his unconscious ward, a section at a time, and took his measure with a string. The king awoke, just as he had completed his work, complained of the cold, and asked what he was doing. "'Tis done now, my liege," said Hendon. "I have a bit of business outside, but will presently return. Sleep thou again. Thou needst it. There, let me cover thy head also. Thou'lt be warmer the sooner." The king was back in dreamland before this speech was ended. Miles slipped softly out, and slipped as softly in again in the course of 30 or 40 minutes, with a complete second-hand suit of boy's clothing, of cheap material, and showing signs of wear, but tidy and suited to the season of the year. He seated himself and began to overhaul his purchase, mumbling to himself, "A longer purse would have got a better sort, but when one has not the long purse, one must be content with what a short one may do.
There was a woman in our town did dwell.
He stirred, methinks. I must sing in a less thunderous key. 'Tis not good to mar his sleep, with this journey before him, and he so wearied out, poor chap. This garment, 'tis well enough. A stitch here and another one there will set it aright. This other is better, albeit a stitch or two will not come amiss in it, likewise. These be very good and sound, and will keep his small feet warm and dry, an odd new thing to him belike, since he has doubtless been used to foot it bare, winters and summers the same. Would thread were bred, seeing one getteth a year's sufficiency for a farthing, and such a brave big needle without cost for mere love. Now shall I have the demon's own time to thread it. And so he had. He did as men have always done, and probably always will do, to the end of time, held the needle still, and tried to thrust the thread through the eye, which is the opposite of a woman's way. Time and time again the thread missed the mark, going sometimes on one side of the needle and sometimes on the other, sometimes doubling up against the shaft. But he was patient, having been through these experiences before, when he was soldiering. He succeeded at last, and took up the garment that had lain waiting, meantime, across his lap, and began his work. The inn is paid, the breakfast that is to come included, and there is wherewithal left to buy a couple of donkeys and meet our little costs for the 2 or 3 days betwixt this and the plenty that awaits us at Hendon Hall. She loved her husband.
Body of me! I have driven the needle under my nail! It matters little. 'Tis not a novelty, yet 'tis not a convenience neither. We shall be merry there, little one, never doubt it. Thy troubles will vanish there, and likewise thy sad distemper. She loved her husband dearly, but another man. These be noble large stitches, holding the garment up and viewing it admiringly. They have a grandeur and a majesty that do cause these small stingy ones of the tailor-man to look mightily paltry and plebeian. She loved her husband dearly, but another man he loved she. Marry, 'tis done, a goodly piece of work, too, and wrought with expedition. Now will I wake him, apparel him, pour for him, feed him, and then will we hie us to the mart by the Tabard Inn in Southwark, and be pleased to rise, my liege. He answereth not. What ho, my liege? Of a truth must I profane his sacred person with a touch, sith his slumber is deaf to speech. What? He threw back the covers. The boy was gone. He stared about him in speechless astonishment for a moment, noticed for the first time that his ward's ragged raiment was also missing, when he began to rage and storm and shout for the innkeeper. At that moment a servant entered with the breakfast. "Explain, thou limb of Satan, or thy time is come!" roared the man of war, and made so savage a spring towards the waiter that this latter could not find his tongue, for the instant, for fright and surprise. "Where is the boy?" In disjointed and trembling syllables the man gave the information desired.
"You were hardly gone from the place, your worship, when a youth came running and said it was your worship's will that the boy come to you straight at the bridge-end on the Southwark side. I brought him hither, and when he woke the lad and gave his message, the lad did grumble some little for being disturbed so early, as he called it, but straightway trussed on his rags and went with the youth, only saying it had been better manners that your worship came yourself, not sent a stranger, and so—"
"And so thou art a fool and easily cozened. Hang all thy breed. Yet mayhap no hurt is done. Possibly no harm is meant the boy. I will go fetch him. Make the table ready. Stay, the coverings of the bed were disposed as if one lay beneath them. Happened that by accident?"
"I know not, good your worship. I saw the youth meddle with them, he that came for the boy."
"Thousand deaths! 'Twas done to deceive me. 'Tis plain 'twas done to gain time. Harkee, was that youth alone?"
"All alone, your worship."
"Art sure?"
"Sure, your worship."
"Collect thy scattered wits. Bethink thee. Take time, man."
After a moment's thought, the servant said,
"When he came, none came with him. But now I remember me that, as the two stepped into the throng of the bridge, a ruffian-looking man plunged out from some near place, and just as he was joining them—"
"What then? Out with it!" thundered the impatient Hendon, interrupting.
Just then the crowd lapped them up and closed them in, and I saw no more, being called by my master, who was in a rage because a joint that the scrivener had ordered was forgot, though I take all the saints to witness that to blame me for that miscarriage were like holding the unborn babe to judgment for sins come
out of my sight, idiot! Thy prating drives me mad! Hold! Whither art flying? Canst not bide still an instant? Went they towards Sullerk?
Even so, your worship, for, as I said before, as to that detestable joint, the babe unborn is no whit more blameless than
art here yet, and prating still? Vanish, lest I throttle thee.
The servitor vanished. Hendon followed after him, passed him, and plunged down the stairs 2 steps at a stride, muttering, 'Tis that scurvy villain that claimed he was his son. I have lost thee, my poor little mad master. It is a bitter thought, and I had come to love thee so.
No, by book and bell, not lost, not lost, for I will ransack the land till I find thee again. Poor child, yonder is his breakfast, and mine, but I have no hunger now, so let the rats have it. Speed, speed, that is the word.' As he wormed his swift way through the noisy multitudes upon the bridge, he several times said to himself, clinging to the thought as if it were a particularly pleasing one, 'He grumbled, but he went. He went, yes, because he thought Miles Hendon asked it. Sweet lad, he would ne'er have done it for another. I know it well.'" End of chapter 13.
Chapter 14. Le roi est mort. Vive le roi. Toward daylight of the same morning, Tom Canty stirred out of a heavy sleep and opened his eyes in the dark. He lay silent a few moments, trying to analyze his confused thoughts and impressions, and get some sort of meaning out of them. Then suddenly he burst out in a rapturous but guarded voice,
"I see it all! I see it all! Now, God be thanked, I am indeed awake at last! Come, joy! Vanish, sorrow! Ho, Nan! Bet! Kick off your straw and hie thee hither to my side, till I do pour into your unbelieving ears the wildest madcap dream that ever the spirits of night did conjure up to astonish the soul of man withal. Ho, Nan, I say! Bet!"
A dim form appeared at his side, and a voice said,
"Wilt deign to deliver thy commands?"
"Commands?
Oh, woe is me, I know thy voice. Speak thou. Who am I?"
"Thou? In sooth, yesternight wert thou the Prince of Wales. Today art thou my most gracious liege, Edward, King of England." Tom buried his head among his pillows, murmuring plaintively,
"Alack, it was no dream. Go to thy rest, sweet sir. Leave me to my sorrows."
Tom slept again, and after a time he had this pleasant dream. He thought it was summer, and he was playing all alone in the fair meadow called Goodman's Fields, when a dwarf only a foot high, with long red whiskers and a humped back, appeared to him suddenly and said,
"Dig by that stump!"
He did so, and found 12 bright new pennies, wonderful riches. Yet this was not the best of it, for the dwarf said,
"I know thee! Thou art a good lad, and a deserving. Thy distress shall end, for the day of thy reward is come. Dig here every seventh day, and thou shalt find always the same treasure, 12 bright new pennies. Tell none, keep the secret."
Then the dwarf vanished, and Tom flew to Offal Court with his prize, saying to himself, "Every night will I give my father a penny. He will think I begged it. It will glad his heart, and I shall no more be beaten. 1 penny every week the good priest that teacheth me shall have, mother, Nan, and Bet the other 4. We be done with hunger and rags now, done with fears and frets and savage usage." In his dream he reached his sordid home all out of breath, but with eyes dancing with grateful enthusiasm, cast 4 of his pennies into his mother's lap, and cried out,
"They are for thee! All of them, every one, for thee and Nan and Bet, and honestly come by, not begged nor stolen."
The happy and astonished mother strained him to her breast and exclaimed, "It waxeth late! May it please your majesty to rise?" Ah, that was not the answer he was expecting. The dream had snapped asunder. He was awake. He opened his eyes. The richly clad first lord of the bedchamber was kneeling by his couch. The gladness of the lying dream faded away. The poor boy recognized that he was still a captive and a king. The room was filled with courtiers clothed in purple mantles, the morning color, and with noble servants of the monarch. Tom sat up in bed and gazed out from the heavy silken curtains upon this fine company. The weighty business of dressing began, and one courtier after another knelt and paid his court and offered to the little king his condolences upon his heavy loss, whilst the dressing proceeded. In the beginning a shirt was taken up by the chief equerry in waiting, who passed it to the first lord of the buckhounds, who passed it to the second gentleman of the bedchamber, who passed it to the head ranger of Windsor Forest, who passed it to the third groom of the stole, who passed it to the Chancellor Royal of the Duchy of Lancaster, who passed it to the Master of the Wardrobe, who passed it to Noroy King-at-Arms, who passed it to the Constable of the Tower, who passed it to the Chief Steward of the Household, who passed it to the Hereditary Grand Diaperer, who passed it to the Lord High Admiral of England, who passed it to the Archbishop of Canterbury, who passed it to the First Lord of the Bedchamber, who took what was left of it and put it on Tom. Poor little wondering chap, it reminded him of passing buckets at a fire. Each garment in its turn had to go through this slow and solemn process. Consequently, Tom grew very weary of the ceremony, so weary that he felt an almost gushing gratefulness when he at last saw his long silken hose begin the journey down the line, and knew that the end of the matter was drawing near. But he exulted too soon. The first lord of the bedchamber received the hose and was about to encase Tom's legs in them, when a sudden flush invaded his face, and he hurriedly hustled the things back into the hands of the Archbishop of Canterbury with an astounded look and a whispered, "See, my lord!" pointing to something connected with the hose. The Archbishop paled, then flushed, and passed the hose to the Lord High Admiral, whispering, "See, my lord!" The Admiral passed the hose to the Hereditary Grand Diaperer, and had hardly breath enough in his body to ejaculate, "See, my lord!" The hose drifted backward along the line to the Chief Steward of the Household, the Constable of the Tower, Noroy King-at-Arms, the Master of the Wardrobe, the Chancellor Royal of the Duchy of Lancaster, the Third Groom of the Stole, the Head Ranger of Windsor Forest, the Second Gentleman of the Bedchamber, the First Lord of the Buckhounds, accompanied always with that amazed and frightened, "See! See!" till they finally reached the hands of the Chief Equerry-in-Waiting, who gazed a moment with a pallid face upon what had caused all this dismay, then hoarsely whispered,
"Body of my life! A tag gone from a truss-point to the tower with the head-keeper of the king's hose!"
After which he leaned upon the shoulder of the first lord of the buckhounds to regather his vanished strength, whilst fresh hose, without any damaged strings to them, were brought. But all things must have an end, and so in time Tom Canty was in a condition to get out of bed. The proper official poured water, the proper official engineered the washing, the proper official stood by with a towel, and by Tom got safely through the purifying stage and was ready for the services of the hairdresser royal. When he at length emerged from this master's hands, he was a gracious figure and as pretty as a girl in his mantle and trunks of purple satin and purple-plumed cap. He now moved in state toward his breakfast-room, through the midst of the courtly assemblage, and as he passed, these fell back, leaving his way free, and dropped upon their knees. After breakfast he was conducted with regal ceremony, attended by his great officers and his guard of 50 gentlemen pensioners bearing gilt battle-axes, to the throne-room, where he proceeded to transact business of state. His uncle, Lord Hertford, took his stand by the throne to assist the royal mind with wise counsel. The body of illustrious men named by the late king as his executors appeared to ask Tom's approval of certain acts of theirs, rather a form, and yet not wholly a form, since there was no protector as yet. The Archbishop of Canterbury made report of the decree of the Council of Executors concerning the obsequies of his late most illustrious majesty, and finished by reading the signatures of the executors, to wit, the Archbishop of Canterbury, the Lord Chancellor of England, William Lord St. John, John Lord Russell, Edward Earl of Hertford, John Viscount Lisle, Cuthbert Bishop of Durham. Tom was not listening. An earlier clause of the document was puzzling him. At this point he turned and whispered to Lord Hertford, "What day did he say the burial hath been appointed for?"
"The 16th of the coming month, my liege."
"'Tis a strange folly. Will he keep?" Poor chap, he was still new to the customs of royalty. He was used to seeing the forlorn dead of Offal Court hustled out of the way with a very different sort of expedition. However, the Lord Hertford set his mind at rest with a word or two. A secretary of state presented an order of the council appointing the morrow at 11 for the reception of the foreign ambassadors, and desired the king's assent. Tom turned an inquiring look toward Hertford, who whispered, "Your Majesty will signify consent. They come to testify their royal master's sense of the heavy calamity which hath visited your grace and the realm of England." Tom did as he was bidden. Another secretary began to read a preamble concerning the expenses of the late king's household, which had amounted to £28,000 during the preceding 6 months, a sum so vast that it made Tom Canty gasp. He gasped again when the fact appeared that £20,000 of this money were still owing and unpaid. Footnote, Hume. End of footnote. And once more, when it appeared that the king's coffers were about empty, and his 1,200 servants much embarrassed for lack of the wages due them, Tom spoke out with lively apprehension. "We be going to the dogs, 'tis plain. 'Tis meet and necessary that we take a smaller house and set the servants at large, sith they be of no value but to make delay, and trouble one with offices that harass the spirit and shame the soul. They misbecoming any but a doll, that hath nor brains nor hands to help itself withal. I remember me of a small house that standeth over against the fish-market, by Billingsgate." A sharp pressure upon Tom's arm stopped his foolish tongue, and sent a blush to his face. But no countenance there betrayed any sign that this strange speech had been remarked or given concern. A secretary made report that, forasmuch as the late king had provided in his will for conferring the ducal degree upon the Earl of Hertford, and raising his brother Sir Thomas Seymour to the peerage, and likewise Hertford's son to an earldom, together with similar aggrandizements to other great servants of the crown, the council had resolved to hold a sitting on the 16th of February for the delivering and confirming of these honours, and that meantime the late king not having granted in writing estates suitable to the support of these dignities, the council, knowing his private wishes in that regard, had thought proper to grant to Seymour £500 lands, and to Hertford's son £800 lands, and £300 of the next bishop's lands which should fall vacant, his present majesty being willing. Footnote, Hume. End of footnote. Tom was about to blurt out something about the propriety of paying the late king's debts first, before squandering all this money, but a timely touch upon his arm from the thoughtful Hertford saved him this indiscretion, wherefore he gave the royal assent without spoken comment, but with much inward discomfort. While he sat reflecting a moment over the ease with which he was doing strange and glittering miracles, a happy thought shot into his mind. Why not make his mother Duchess of Offal Court, and give her an estate? But a sorrowful thought swept it instantly away. He was only a king in name. These grave veterans and great nobles were his masters. To them his mother was only the creature of a diseased mind. They would simply listen to his project with unbelieving ears, then send for the doctor. The dull work went tediously on. Petitions were read, and proclamations, patents, and all manner of wordy, repetitious, and wearisome papers relating to the public business, and at last Tom sighed pathetically and murmured to himself, "In what have I offended, that the good Lord should take me away from the fields and the free air and the sunshine, to shut me up here and make me a king and afflict me so?" Then his poor muddled head nodded a while, and presently drooped to his shoulder, and the business of the empire came to a standstill for want of that august factor, the ratifying power. Silence ensued around the slumbering child, and the sages of the realm ceased from their deliberations. During the forenoon Tom had an enjoyable hour, by permission of his keepers, Hertford and St. John, with the Lady Elizabeth and the little Lady Jane Grey, though the spirits of the princesses were rather subdued by the mighty stroke that had fallen upon the royal house, and at the end of the visit his elder sister, afterwards the Bloody Mary of history, chilled him with a solemn interview which had but one merit in his eyes, its brevity. He had a few moments to himself, and then a slim lad of about 12 years of age was admitted to his presence, whose clothing, except his snowy ruff and the laces about his wrists, was of black, doublet, hose, and all. He bore no badge of mourning, but a knot of purple ribbon on his shoulder. He advanced hesitatingly, with head bowed and bare, and dropped upon one knee in front of Tom. Tom sat still and contemplated him soberly a moment, and then he said, "Rise, lad, who art thou? What wouldst have?" The boy rose and stood at graceful ease, but with an aspect of concern in his face. He said,
"Oh, a surety thou must remember me, my lord. I am thy whipping boy."
"My whipping boy?"
"The same, your grace. I am Humphrey, Humphrey Marlowe."
Tom perceived that here was someone whom his keepers ought to have posted him about. The situation was delicate. What should he do? Pretend he knew this lad, and then betray by his every utterance that he had never heard of him before? No, that would not do. An idea came to his relief. Accidents like this might be likely to happen with some frequency, now that business urgencies would often call Hertford and St. John from his side, they being members of the Council of Executors. Therefore, perhaps it would be well to strike out a plan himself to meet the requirements of such emergencies. Yes, that would be a wise course. He would practice on this boy, and see what sort of success he might achieve. So he stroked his brow perplexedly a moment or two, and presently said,
"Now, I seem to remember thee somewhat, but my wit is clogged and dim with suffering." "Alack, my poor master!" ejaculated the whipping boy with feeling, adding to himself, "In truth, 'tis as they said, his mind is gone. Alas, poor soul! But misfortune catch me, how am I forgetting? They said one must not seem to observe that aught is wrong with him." "'Tis strange how my memory doth wanton with me these days," said Tom. "But mind it not, I mend apace. A little clue doth often serve to bring me back again the things and names which had escaped me, and not they only, forsooth, but e'en such as I ne'er heard before, as this lad shall see. Give thy business speech." "'Tis matter of small weight, my liege, yet will I touch upon it, an it please your grace. 2 days gone by, when your majesty faltered thrice in your Greek, in the morning lessons, doth remember it?"
"Yes, methinks I do. It is not much of a lie. An I had meddled with the Greek at all, I had not faltered simply thrice, but 40 times.
Yes, I do recall it now. Go on."
"The master, being wroth with what he termed such slovenly and doltish work, did promise that he would soundly whip me for it, and—"
"Whip thee?" said Tom, astonished out of his presence of mind. "Why should he whip thee for faults of mine?"
"Ah, your grace forgetteth again. He always scourgeth me when thou dost fail in thy lessons."
"True, true. I had forgot. Thou teachest me in private. Then I fail.
He argueth that thy office was lamely done, and—"
"Oh, my liege, what words are these? I, the humblest of thy servants, presume to teach thee?
Then where is thy blame? What riddle is this? Am I in truth gone mad, or is it thou? Explain, speak out."
"But good, your majesty, there's naught that needeth simplifying. None may visit the sacred person of the Prince of Wales with blows, wherefore, when he faulteth, 'tis I that take them, and meet it is, and right, for that it is mine office and my livelihood."
[Footnote: The whipping boy. James the First and Charles the Second had whipping boys, when they were little fellows, to take their punishment for them when they fell short in their lessons. So I have ventured to furnish my small prince with one, for my own purposes. End of footnote. Tom stared at the tranquil boy, observing to himself, "Lo, it is a wonderful thing, a most strange and curious trade. I marvel they have not hired a boy to take my combings and my dressings for me. Would heaven they would, and they will do this thing. I will take my lashings in mine own person, giving God thanks for the change." Then he said aloud,
"And hast thou been beaten, poor friend, according to the promise?"
"No, good your majesty, my punishment was appointed for this day, and peradventure it may be annulled, as unbefitting the season of mourning. That is come upon us. I know not, and so have made bold to come hither and remind your grace about your gracious promise to intercede in my behalf."
"With the master? To save thee thy whipping?"
"Ah, thou dost remember. My memory mendeth, thou seest. Set thy mind at ease. Thy back shall go unscathed. I will see to it."
"Oh, thanks, my good lord," cried the boy, dropping upon his knee again. "Mayhap I have ventured far enow, and yet—"
Seeing Master Humphrey hesitate, Tom encouraged him to go on, saying he was in the granting mood.
"Then I will speak it out, for it lieth near my heart. Sith thou art no more Prince of Wales, but King, thou canst order matters as thou wilt, with none to say thee nay. Wherefore it is not in reason that thou wilt longer vex thyself with dreary studies, but wilt burn thy books and turn thy mind to things less irksome. then am I ruined, and mine orphan sisters with me.
Ruined? Prithee, how?
My back is my bread, O my gracious liege. If it go idle, I starve. And thou cease from study, mine office is gone. Thou'lt need no whipping boy. Do not turn me away.
Tom was touched with this pathetic distress. He said with a right royal burst of generosity,
"Discomfort thyself no further, lad. Thine office shall be permanent in thee, and thy line for ever."
Then he struck the boy a light blow on the shoulder with the flat of his sword, exclaiming, "Rise, Humphrey Marlowe, hereditary grand whipping boy to the royal house of England. Banish sorrow. I will betake me to my books again, and study so ill that they must in justice treble thy wage, so mightily shall the business of thine office be augmented."
The grateful Humphrey responded fervently, "Thanks, O most noble master! This princely lavishness doth far surpass my most distempered dreams of fortune. Now shall I be happy all my days, and all the house of Marlowe after me."
Tom had wit enough to perceive that here was a lad who could be useful to him. He encouraged Humphrey to talk, and he was nothing loath. He was delighted to believe that he was helping in Tom's cure, for always, as soon as he had finished calling back to Tom's diseased mind the various particulars of his experiences and adventures in the royal schoolroom and elsewhere about the palace, he noticed that Tom was then able to recall the circumstances quite clearly. At the end of an hour, Tom found himself well freighted with very valuable information concerning personages and matters pertaining to the court. So he resolved to draw instruction from this source daily, and to this end he would give order to admit Humphrey to the royal closet whenever he might come, provided the Majesty of England was not engaged with other people. Humphrey had hardly been dismissed when my Lord Hertford arrived with more trouble for Tom. He said that the lords of the council, fearing that some overwrought report of the king's damaged health might have leaked out and got abroad, they deemed it wise and best that his Majesty should begin to dine in public after a day or two, his wholesome complexion and vigorous step, assisted by a carefully guarded repose of manner and ease and grace of demeanor, would more surely quiet the general pulse, in case any evil rumors had gone out, than any other scheme that could be devised. Then the Earl proceeded very delicately to instruct Tom as to the observances proper to the stately occasion, under the rather thin disguise of reminding him concerning things already known to him. But to his vast gratification it turned out that Tom needed very little help in this line. He had been making use of Humphrey in that direction, for Humphrey had mentioned that within a few days he was to begin to dine in public, having gathered it from the swift-winged gossip of the court. Tom kept these facts to himself, however. Seeing the royal memory so improved, the Earl ventured to apply a few tests to it, in an apparently casual way, to find out how far its amendment had progressed. The results were happy here and there, in spots where Humphrey's tracks remained, and on the whole my lord was greatly pleased and encouraged. So encouraged was he, indeed, that he spoke up and said in a quiet, hopeful voice, "Now am I persuaded that if your Majesty will but tax your memory yet a little further, it will resolve the puzzle of the Great Seal, a loss which was of moment yesterday, although of none today, since its term of service ended with our late lord's life. May it please your grace to make the trial?" Tom was at sea. A great seal was a something which he was totally unacquainted with. After a moment's hesitation, he looked up innocently and asked,
"What was it like, my lord?"
The Earl started almost imperceptibly, muttering to himself, "Alack, his wits are flown again. It was ill wisdom to lead him on to strain them." Then he deftly turned the talk to other matters, with the purpose of sweeping the unlucky seal out of Tom's thoughts, a purpose which easily succeeded. End of chapter 14. Chapter 15. Tom as King. The next day the foreign ambassadors came with their gorgeous trains, and Tom, throned in awful state, received them. The splendors of the scene delighted his eye and fired his imagination at first, but the audience was long and dreary, and so were most of the addresses, wherefore what began as a pleasure grew into weariness and homesickness by and by. Tom said the words which Hertford put into his mouth from time to time, and tried hard to acquit himself satisfactorily, but he was too new to such things, and too ill at ease to accomplish more than a tolerable success. He looked sufficiently like a king, but he was ill able to feel like one. He was cordially glad when the ceremony was ended. The larger part of his day was wasted, as he termed it in his own mind, in labors pertaining to his royal office. Even the 2 hours devoted to certain princely pastimes and recreations were rather a burden to him than otherwise, they were so fettered by restrictions and ceremonious observances. However, he had a private hour with his whipping boy, which he counted clear gain, since he got both entertainment and needful information out of it. The third day of Tom Canty's kingship came and went much as the others had done, but there was a lifting of his cloud in one way. He felt less uncomfortable than at first. He was getting a little used to his circumstances and surroundings. His chains still galled, but not all the time. He found that the presence and homage of the great afflicted and embarrassed him less and less sharply with every hour that drifted over his head. But for one single dread, he could have seen the fourth day approach without serious distress. The dining in public, it was to begin that day. There were greater matters in the program, for on that day he would have to preside at a council which would take his views and commands concerning the policy to be pursued toward various foreign nations scattered far and near over the great globe. On that day, too, Hertford would be formally chosen to the grand office of Lord Protector. Other things of note were appointed for that fourth day also, but to Tom they were all insignificant compared with the ordeal of dining all by himself, with a multitude of curious eyes fastened upon him, and a multitude of mouths whispering comments upon his performance, and upon his mistakes, if he should be so unlucky as to make any. Still, nothing could stop that fourth day, and so it came. It found poor Tom low-spirited and absent-minded, and this mood continued. He could not shake it off. The ordinary duties of the morning dragged upon his hands and wearied him. Once more he felt the sense of captivity heavy upon him. Late in the forenoon he was in a large audience-chamber conversing with the Earl of Hertford, and dully awaiting the striking of the hour appointed for a visit of ceremony from a considerable number of great officials and courtiers. After a little while Tom, who had wandered to a window and become interested in the life and movement of the great highway beyond the palace gates, and not idly interested, but longing with all his heart to take part in person in its stir and freedom, saw the van of a hooting and shouting mob of disorderly men, women, and children of the lowest and poorest degree approaching from up the road. "I would I knew what 'tis about," he exclaimed, with all a boy's curiosity in such happenings. "Thou art king," solemnly responded the Earl with a reverence. "Have I your Grace's leave to act?" "Oh, blithely, yes! Oh, gladly, yes!" exclaimed Tom excitedly, adding to himself, with a lively sense of satisfaction, "In truth, being a king is not all dreariness. It hath its compensations and conveniences." The Earl called a page, and sent him to the captain of the guard with the order, "Let the mob be halted, and inquiry made concerning the occasion of its movement, by the king's command." A few seconds later a long rank of the royal guards, cased in flashing steel, filed out at the gates and formed across the highway in front of the multitude. A messenger returned to report that the crowd were following a man, a woman, and a young girl to execution for crimes committed against the peace and dignity of the realm. Death, and a violent death, for these poor unfortunates. The thought wrung Tom's heartstrings. The spirit of compassion took control of him, to the exclusion of all other considerations. He never thought of the offended laws, or of the grief or loss which these three criminals had inflicted upon their victims. He could think of nothing but the scaffold and the grisly fate hanging over the heads of the condemned. His concern even made him forget for the moment that he was but the false shadow of a king, not the substance, and before he knew it he had blurted out the command, "Bring them here!" Then he flushed scarlet, and a sort of apology sprung to his lips. But observing that his order had wrought no sort of a surprise in the Earl or the waiting page, he suppressed the words he was about to utter. The page, in the most matter-of-course way, made a profound obeisance, and retired backwards out of the room to deliver the command. Tom experienced a glow of pride and a renewed sense of the compensating advantages of the kingly office. He said to himself,
Truly, it is like what I was used to feel when I read the old priest's tales, and did imagine mine own self a prince, giving law and command to all, saying, do this, do that, whilst none durst offer let or hindrance to my will."
Now the doors swung open, one high-sounding title after another was announced, the personages owning them followed, and the place was quickly half-filled with noble folk and finery. But Tom was hardly conscious of the presence of these people, so wrought up was he, and so intensely absorbed in that other and more interesting matter. He seated himself, absently, in his chair of state, and turned his eyes upon the door with manifestations of impatient expectancy, seeing which the company forbore to trouble him, and fell to chatting a mixture of public business and court gossip one with another. In a little while the measured tread of military men was heard approaching, and the culprits entered the presence in charge of an under-sheriff and escorted by a detail of the King's Guard. The civil officer knelt before Tom, then stood aside. The three doomed persons knelt also, and remained so. The guard took position behind Tom's chair. Tom scanned the prisoners curiously. Something about the dress or appearance of the man had stirred a vague memory in him.
"Methinks I have seen this man ere now, but the when or the where fail me,"
such was Tom's thought. Just then the man glanced meekly up, and quickly dropped his face again, not being able to endure the awful port of sovereignty. But the one full glimpse of the face which Tom got was sufficient. He said to himself, "Now is the matter clear. This is the stranger that plucked Gil's wit out of the Thames, and saved his life, that windy, bitter first day of the new year. A brave, good deed. Pity he hath been doing baser ones, and got himself in this sad case. I have not forgot the day, neither the hour, by reason that an hour after, upon the stroke of 11, I did get a hiding by the hand of Gammer Ganty, which is of so goodly and admired severity that all that went before or followed after it were but fondlings and caress by comparison." Tom now ordered that the woman and the girl be removed from the presence for a little time, then addressed himself to the under-sheriff, saying,
"Good sir, what is this man's offence?"
The officer knelt and answered,
"So please your majesty, he hath taken the life of a subject by poison."
Tom's compassion for the prisoner, and admiration of him as the daring rescuer of a drowning boy, experienced a most damaging shock.
"The thing was proven upon him?" he asked.
"Most clearly, sire."
Tom sighed and said,
"Take him away, he hath earned his death. 'Tis a pity, for he was a brave heart. Nana, I mean, he hath the look of it."
The prisoner clasped his hands together with sudden energy and wrung them despairingly, at the same time appealing imploringly to the King in broken and terrified phrases.
"O, my lord the King, and thou canst pity the lost, have pity upon me. I am innocent, neither hath that wherewith I am charged been more than but lamely proved. Yet I speak not of that. The judgment is gone forth against me, and may not suffer alteration. Yet in mine extremity I beg a boon, for my doom is more than I can bear. A grace, my lord the King, in thy royal compassion grant me my prayer. Give commandment that I be hanged."
Tom was amazed. This was not the outcome he had looked for.
"Odds my life, a strange boon! Was it not the fate intended thee?" "Oh, good my liege, not so! It is ordered that I be boiled alive."
The hideous surprise of these words almost made Tom spring from his chair. As soon as he could recover his wits, he cried out,
"Have thy wish, poor soul, and thou had poisoned 100 men, thou shouldst not suffer so miserable a death."
The prisoner bowed his face to the ground and burst into passionate expressions of gratitude, ending with,
"If ever thou shouldst know misfortune, which God forfend, may thy goodness to me this day be remembered and requited."
Tom turned to the Earl of Hertford and said,
"My lord, is it believable that there was warrant for this man's ferocious doom?"
"It is the law, your grace, for poisoners. In Germany, coiners be boiled to death in oil, not cast in of a sudden, but by a rope let down into the oil by degrees, and slowly, first the feet, then the legs, then—"
"Oh, prithee, no more, my lord, I cannot bear it,"
cried Tom, covering his eyes with his hands to shut out the picture.
"I beseech your good lordship that order be taken to change this law. Oh, let no more poor creatures be visited with its tortures."
The Earl's face showed profound gratification, for he was a man of merciful and generous impulses, a thing not very common with his class in that fierce age. He said, "These, your Grace's noble words, have sealed its doom. History will remember it to the honour of your royal house." The under-sheriff was about to remove his prisoner. Tom gave him a sign to wait, and then he said,
"Good sir, I would look into this matter further. The man has said his deed was but lamely proved. Tell me what thou knowest."
"If the King's Grace please, it did appear upon the trial that this man entered into a house in the hamlet of Islington, where one lay sick. Three witnesses say it was at 10 o'clock in the morning, and two say it was some minutes later, the sick man being alone at the time and sleeping. And presently the man came forth again and went his way. The sick man died within the hour, being torn with spasms and retchings."
"Did any see the poison given? Was poison found?"
"Marry, no, my liege."
"Then how doth one know there was poison given at all?"
"Please your Majesty, the doctors testified that none die with such symptoms but by poison."
Weighty evidence this, in that simple age. Tom recognized its formidable nature, and said,
"The doctor knoweth his trade. Belike they were right. The matter hath an ill look for this poor man."
"Yet was not this all, your Majesty. There is more and worse. Many testified that a witch, since gone from the village, none know whither, did foretell and speak it privately in their ears, that the sick man would die by poison, and more, that a stranger would give it, a stranger with brown hair and clothed in a worn and common garb. And surely this prisoner doth answer woundily to the bill, please your Majesty, to give this circumstance that solemn weight which is its due, seeing it was foretold."
This was an argument of tremendous force in that superstitious day. Tom felt that the thing was settled. If evidence was worth anything, this poor fellow's guilt was proved. Still he offered the prisoner a chance, saying,
"If thou canst say aught in thyself, speak."
"Not that will avail, my king. I am innocent, yet cannot I make it appear. I have no friends, else might I show that I was not in Islington that day. So also might I show that at that hour they name, I was above a league away, seeing I was at Wapping Old Stairs. Yea, more, my king, for I could show that whilst they say I was taking life, I was saving it, a drowning boy. Peace! Sheriff, name the day the deed was done."
"At 10 in the morning, or some minutes later, the first day of the new year, most illustrious—"
"Let the prisoner go free. It's the king's will."
Another blush followed this unregal outburst, and he covered his indecorum as well as he could by adding,
"It enrageth me that a man should be hanged upon such idle, hare-brained evidence."
A low buzz of admiration swept through the assemblage. It was not admiration of the decree that had been delivered by Tom, for the propriety or expediency of pardoning a convicted poisoner was a thing which few there would have felt justified in either admitting or admiring. No, the admiration was for the intelligence and spirit which Tom had displayed. Some of the low-voiced remarks were to this effect:
"This is no mad king. He hath his wits sound.
How sanely he puts his questions! How like his former natural self was this abrupt, imperious disposal of the matter!
God be thanked, his infirmity is spent! This is no weakling, but a king! He hath borne himself like to his own father!"
The air being filled with applause, Tom's ear necessarily caught a little of it. The effect which this had upon him was to put him greatly at his ease, and also to charge his system with very gratifying sensations. However, his juvenile curiosity soon rose superior to these pleasant thoughts and feelings. He was eager to know what sort of a deadly mischief the woman and the little girl could have been about. So, by his command, the two terrified and sobbing creatures were brought before him.
"What is it that these have done?" he inquired of the sheriff.
"Please your Majesty, a black crime is charged upon them, and clearly proven. Wherefore the judges have decreed, according to the law, that they be hanged. They sold themselves to the devil, such is their crime."
Tom shuddered. He had been taught to abhor people who did this wicked thing. Still, he was not going to deny himself the pleasure of feeding his curiosity for all that, so he asked,
"Where was this done, and when?"
"On a midnight in December, in a ruined church, your Majesty."
Tom shuddered again. "Who was there present?"
only these two, your grace, and that other."
"Have these confessed?"
"Nay, not so, sire, they do deny it."
"Then, prithee, how was it known?"
"Certain witnesses did see them wending thither, good your majesty. This bred the suspicion, and dire effects have since confirmed and justified it. In particular, it is in evidence that through the wicked power so obtained, they did invoke and bring about a storm that wasted all the region round about. About 40 witnesses have proved the storm, and sooth one might have had 1,000, for all had reason to remember it, sith all had suffered by it."
"Certes, this is serious matter." Tom turned this dark piece of scoundrelism over in his mind a while, and then asked, "Suffered the woman also by the storm?" Several old heads among the assemblage nodded their recognition of the wisdom of this question. The sheriff, however, saw nothing consequential in the inquiry. He answered with simple directness,
"Indeed did she, your majesty, and most righteously, as all avar. Her habitation was swept away, and herself and child left shelterless."
"Methinks the power to do herself so ill a turn was dearly bought. She had been cheated, had she paid but a farthing for it. That she paid her soul and her child's argueth that she is mad. If she is mad, she knoweth not what she doth, therefore sinneth not."
The elderly heads nodded recognition of Tom's wisdom once more, and one individual murmured,
"And the king be mad himself, according to report, then it is a madness of a sort that would improve the sanity of some I wot of, if by the gentle providence of God they could but catch it."
"What age hath the child?" asked Tom.
9 years, please your majesty."
"By the law of England may a child enter into covenant and sell itself, my lord?" asked Tom, turning to a learned judge.
"The law doth not permit a child to make or meddle in any weighty matter, good my liege, holding that its callow wit unfitteth it to cope with the riper wit and evil schemings of them that are its elders. The devil may buy a child, if he so choose, and the child agree thereto, but not an Englishman. In this latter case the contract would be null and void."
"It seemeth a rude unchristian thing, and ill-contrived, that English law denieth privileges to Englishmen to waste them on the devil," cried Tom with honest heat. This novel view of the matter excited many smiles, and was stored away in many heads to be repeated about the court as evidence of Tom's originality as well as progress toward mental health. The elder culprit had ceased from sobbing, and was hanging upon Tom's words with an excited interest and a growing hope. Tom noticed this, and it strongly inclined his sympathies toward her in her perilous and unfriended situation. Presently he asked, "How wrought they to bring the storm?"
"By pulling off their stockings, sire."
This astonished Tom, and also fired his curiosity to fever heat. He said eagerly, "It is wonderful. Hath it always this dread effect?"
"Always, my liege, at least if the woman doth desire it, and utter the needful words, either in her mind or with her tongue."
Tom turned to the woman and said with impetuous zeal,
"Exert thy power. I would see a storm."
There was a sudden paling of cheeks in the superstitious assemblage, and a general, though unexpressed, desire to get out of the place, all of which was lost upon Tom, who was dead to everything but the proposed cataclysm. Seeing a puzzled and astonished look in the woman's face, he added excitedly,
"Never fear, thou shalt be blameless. More, thou shalt go free. None shall touch thee. Exert thy power."
"Oh, my lord the king, I have it not. I have been falsely accused."
"Thy fears stay thee. Be of good heart, thou shalt suffer no harm. Make a storm, it mattereth not how small a one. I require not great or harmful, but indeed prefer the opposite. Do this, and thy life is spared. Thou shalt go out free, with thy child, bearing the king's pardon, and safe from hurt or malice from any in the realm."
The woman prostrated herself, and protested with tears that she had no power to do the miracle, else she would gladly win her child's life alone, and be content to lose her own, if by obedience to the king's command so precious a grace might be acquired. Tom urged. The woman still adhered to her declarations. Finally he said,
"I think the woman hath said true, and my mother were in her place, and gifted with the devil's functions. She had not stayed a moment to call her storms, and lay the whole land in ruins, if the saving of my forfeit life were the price she got. It is argument that other mothers are made in like mould.
Thou art free, good wife, thou and thy child, for I do think thee innocent. Now thou'st naught to fear being pardoned. Pull off thy stockings, and thou canst make me a storm. Thou shalt be rich."
The redeemed creature was loud in her gratitude, and proceeded to obey, whilst Tom looked on with eager expectancy, a little marred by apprehension, the courtiers at the same time manifesting decided discomfort and uneasiness. The woman stripped her own feet and her little girl's also, and plainly did her best to reward the king's generosity with an earthquake, but it was all a failure and a disappointment. Tom sighed and said,
"There, good soul, trouble thyself no further. Thy power is departed out of thee. Go thy way in peace, and if it return to thee at any time, forget me not, but fetch me a storm."
Footnote. Character of Hertford. The young king discovered an extreme attachment to his uncle, who was, in the main, a man of moderation and probity. Hume's History of England, Volume 3, page 324. But if he, the protector, gave offence by assuming too much state, he deserves great praise on account of the laws passed this session, by which the rigour of former statutes was much mitigated, and some security given to the freedom of the Constitution. All laws were repealed which extended the crime of treason beyond the statute of the 25th of Edward III. All laws enacted during the late reign extending the crime of felony, all the former laws against Lollardy or heresy, together with a statute of the 6 articles, none were to be accused for words, but within a month after they were spoken. By these repeals several of the most rigorous laws that ever passed in England were annulled, and some dawn, both of civil and religious liberty, began to appear to the people. A repeal also passed of that law, the destruction of all laws, by which the king's proclamation was made of equal force with a statute. Ibid, Volume 3, page 339. End of Chapter 15.
Chapter 16. The State Dinner. The dinner hour drew near, yet strangely enough the thought brought but slight discomfort to Tom, and hardly any terror. The morning's experiences had wonderfully built up his confidence. The poor little ash cat was already more wanted to his strange garret after 4 days' habit than a mature person could have become in a full month. A child's facility in accommodating itself to circumstances was never more strikingly illustrated. Let us privileged ones hurry to the great banqueting room and have a glance at matters there whilst Tom is being made ready for the imposing occasion. It is a spacious apartment with gilded pillars and pilasters and pictured walls and ceilings. At the door stand tall guards as rigid as statues, dressed in rich and picturesque costumes, and bearing halberds. In a high gallery which runs all around the place is a band of musicians and a packed company of citizens of both sexes in brilliant attire. In the center of the room, upon a raised platform, is Tom's table. Now let the ancient chronicler speak.
"A gentleman enters the room bearing a rod, and along with him another bearing a tablecloth, which, after they have both kneeled 3 times with the utmost veneration, he spreads upon the table, and, after kneeling again, they both retire. They come 2 others, one with the rod again, the other with a salt-cellar, a plate, and bread. When they have kneeled, as the others had done, and placed what was brought upon the table, they too retire with the same ceremonies performed by the first. At last come 2 nobles, richly clothed, one bearing a tasting knife, who, after prostrating themselves 3 times in the most graceful manner, approach and rub the table with bread and salt, with as much awe as if the king had been present. Footnote. Leigh Hunt's The Town, page 408, quotation from an early tourist. End of footnote. So end the solemn preliminaries. Now, far down the echoing corridors, we hear a bugle blast and the indistinct cry,
"Place for the king! Way for the king's most excellent majesty!"
These sounds are momently repeated, they grow nearer and nearer, and pleasantly, almost in our faces, the martial note peals, and the cry rings out,
"Way for the king!"
At this instant the shining pageant appears, and files in at the door, with a measured march. Let the chronicler speak again.
First come gentlemen, barons, earls, knights of the garter, all richly dressed and bareheaded. Next comes the chancellor, between two, one of which carries the royal sceptre, the other the sword of state in a red scabbard, studded with golden fleur-de-lis, the point upwards. Next comes the king himself, whom, upon his appearing, 12 trumpets and many drums salute with a great burst of welcome, whilst all in the galleries rise in their places, crying, God save the king! After him come nobles attached to his person, and on his right and left march his guard of honor, his 50 gentlemen pensioners, with gilt battle-axes.
This was all fine and pleasant. Tom's pulse beat high, and a glad light was in his eye. He bore himself right gracefully, and all the more so because he was not thinking of how he was doing it, his mind being charmed and occupied with the blithe sights and sounds about him. And besides, nobody can be very ungraceful in nicely fitting beautiful clothes after he has grown a little used to them, especially if he is for the moment unconscious of them. Tom remembered his instructions, and acknowledged his greeting with a slight inclination of his plumed head and a courteous,
"I thank ye, my good people."
He seated himself at table, without removing his cap, and did it without the least embarrassment, for to eat with one's cap on was the one solitary royal custom upon which the kings and the canties met as upon common ground, neither party having any advantage over the other in the matter of old familiarity with it. The pageant broke up, and grouped itself picturesquely, and remained bare-headed. Now, to the sound of gay music, the yeomen of the guard entered.
The tallest and mightiest men in England, they being carefully selected in this regard.
But we will let the chronicler tell about it.
The yeomen of the guard entered, bare-headed, clothed in scarlet, with golden roses upon their backs, and these went and came, bringing in each turn a course of dishes, served in plate. These dishes were received by a gentleman in the same order they were brought, and placed upon the table, while the taster gave to each guard a mouthful to eat of the particular dish he had brought, for fear of any poison.
Tom made a good dinner, notwithstanding he was conscious that hundreds of eyes followed each morsel to his mouth and watched him eat it with an interest which could not have been more intense if it had been a deadly explosive, and was expected to blow him up and scatter him all about the place. He was careful not to hurry, and equally careful not to do anything whatever for himself, but wait till the proper official knelt down and did it for him. He got through without a mistake, a flawless and precious triumph. When the meal was over at last, and he marched away in the midst of his bright pageant, with the happy noises in his ears of blaring bugles, rolling drums, and thundering acclamations, he felt that if he had seen the worst of dining in public, it was an ordeal which he would be glad to endure several times a day, if by that means he could but buy himself free from some of the more formidable requirements of his royal office. End of chapter 16. Chapter 17. Fufu the First. Miles Hendon hurried along toward the southern end of the bridge, keeping a sharp lookout for the persons he sought, and hoping and expecting to overtake them presently. He was disappointed in this, however. By asking questions he was enabled to track them part of the way through Southwark, then all traces ceased, and he was perplexed as to how to proceed. Still, he continued his efforts as best he could during the rest of the day. Nightfall found him leg-weary, half-famished, and his desire as far from accomplishment as ever. So he supped at the Tabard Inn, and went to bed, resolved to make an early start in the morning, and give the town an exhaustive search. As he lay thinking and planning, he presently began to reason thus. The boy would escape from the ruffian, his reputed father, if possible. Would he go back to London and seek his former haunts? No, he would not do that. He would avoid recapture. What, then, would he do? Never having had a friend in the world or a protector until he met Miles Hendon, he would naturally try to find that friend again, provided the effort did not require him to go toward London in danger. He would strike for Hendon Hall. That is what he would do, for he knew Hendon was homeward bound, and there he might expect to find him. Yes, the case was plain to Hendon. He must lose no more time in Southwark, but move at once through Ghent toward Monk's home, searching the wood and inquiring as he went. Let us return to the vanished little king now. The ruffian, whom the waiter at the inn on the bridge saw about to join the youth and the king, did not exactly join them, but fell in close behind them and followed their steps. He said nothing. His left arm was in a sling, and he wore a large green patch over his left eye. He limped slightly, and used an oaken staff as a support. The youth led the king a crooked course through Southwark, and by and by struck into High Road beyond. The king was irritated now, and said he would stop here. It was Hendon's place to come to him, not his to go to Hendon. He would not endure such insolence. He would stop where he was. The youth said,
"Thou tarry here, and thy friend lying wounded in the wood yonder? So be it, then."
The king's manner changed at once, and he cried out,
"Wounded? And who hath dared to do it? But that is apart. Lead on, lead on, faster, sirrah. Art shod with lead? Wounded is he? Now, though the doer of it be a duke's son, he shall rue it."
It was some distance to the wood, but the space was speedily traversed. The youth looked about him, discovered a bow sticking in the ground, with a small bit of rag tied to it, then led the way into the forest, watching for similar bows, and finding them at intervals. They were evidently guides to the point he was aiming at. By and by an open place was reached, where were the charred remains of a farmhouse, and near them a barn which was falling to ruin and decay. There was no sign of life anywhere, and utter silence prevailed. The youth entered the barn, the king following eagerly upon his heels. No one there. The king shot a surprised and suspicious glance at the youth, and asked,
"Where is he?"
A mocking laugh was his answer. The king was in a rage in a moment. He seized a billet of wood and was in the act of charging upon the youth when another mocking laugh fell upon his ear. It was from the lame ruffian who had been following at a distance. The king turned and said angrily,
"Who art thou? What is thy business here?"
"Leave thy foolery," said the man, "and quiet thyself. My disguise is none so good that thou canst pretend thou knowest not thy father through it."
"Thou art not my father. I know thee not. I am the king. If thou hast hid my servant, find him for me, or thou shalt sup sorrow for what thou hast done."
John Canty replied in a stern and measured voice,
"It is plain thou art mad, and I am loath to punish thee. But if thou provoke me, I must. Thy prating doth no harm here, where there are no ears that need to mind thy follies. Yet is it well to practice thy tongue to wary speech, that it may do no hurt when our quarters change. I have done a murder, and may not tarry at home, neither shalt thou, seeing I need thy service. My name is changed, for wise reasons. It is Hobbs, John Hobbs. Thine is Jack. Charge thy memory accordingly. Now then, speak. Where is thy mother? Where are thy sisters? They came not to the place appointed. Knowest thou whither they went?"
The king answered sullenly,
"Trouble me not with these riddles. My mother is dead. My sisters are in the palace."
The youth nearby burst into a derisive laugh, and the king would have assaulted him. But Canty, or Hobbs, as he now called himself, prevented him and said,
"Peace, Hugo, vex him not. His mind is astray, and thy ways fret him. Sit thee down, Jack, and quiet thyself. Thou shalt have a morsel to eat anon."
Hobbs and Hugo fell to talking together in low voices, and the king removed himself as far as he could from their disagreeable company. He withdrew into the twilight of the farther end of the barn. When he found the earthen floor bedded a foot deep with straw, he lay down here, drew straw over himself in lieu of blankets, and was soon absorbed in thinkings. He had many griefs, but the minor ones were swept almost into forgetfulness by the supreme one, the loss of his father. To the rest of the world the name of Henry VIII brought a shiver, and suggested an ogre whose nostrils breathed destruction, and whose hand dealt scourgings and death. But to this boy the name brought only sensations of pleasure. The figure it invoked wore a countenance that was all gentleness and affection. He called to mind a long succession of loving passages between his father and himself, and dwelt fondly upon them, his unstinted tears attesting how deep and real was the grief that possessed his heart. As the afternoon wasted away, the lad, wearied with his troubles, sank gradually into a tranquil and healing slumber. After a considerable time, he could not tell how long, his senses struggled to a half-consciousness, and as he lay with closed eyes, vaguely wondering where he was and what had been happening, he noted a murmurous sound, the sullen beating of rain upon the roof. A snug sense of comfort stole over him, which was rudely broken the next moment by a chorus of piping cackles and coarse laughter. It startled him disagreeably, and he unmuffled his head to see whence this interruption proceeded. A grim and unsightly picture met his eye. A bright fire was burning in the middle of the floor at the other end of the barn, and around it, and lit weirdly up by the red glare, lolled and sprawled the motliest company of tattered gutter scum and ruffians, of both sexes, he had ever read or dreamed of. There were huge, stalwart men, brown with exposure, long-haired and clothed in fantastic rags. There were middle-sized youths of truculent countenance, and similarly clad. There were blind mendicants with patched or bandaged eyes, crippled ones with wooden legs and crutches. There was a villain-looking peddler with his pack, a knife-grinder, a tinker, and a barber-surgeon with the implements of their trades. Some of the females were hardly grown girls, some were at prime, some were old and wrinkled hags, and all were loud, brazen, foul-mouthed, and all soiled and slatternly. There were three sore-faced babies. There were a couple of starveling curs with strings about their necks, whose office was to lead the blind. The night was come. The gang had just finished feasting. An orgy was beginning. The can of liquor was passing from mouth to mouth. A general cry broke forth.
"A song! A song from the bat, and Dick Doughton go one!"
One of the blind men got up, and made ready by casting aside the patches that sheltered his excellent eyes, and the pathetic placard which recited the cause of his calamity. Doughton go one disencumbered himself of his timber leg, and took his place upon sound and healthy limbs, beside his fellow rascal. Then they roared out a rollicking ditty, and were reinforced by the whole crew at the end of each stanza in a rousing chorus. By the time the last stanza was reached, the half-drunken enthusiasm had risen to such a pitch that everybody joined in and sang it clear through from the beginning, producing a volume of villainous sound that made the rafters quake. These were the inspiring words. "Be'en darkmans then, bows, mort, and ken, the be'en coves beings awast, on chaties to trine by Rome coves dine, for his long lib at last. Binged out being morts and tour, and tour, bing out of the Rome vile bine, and tour the cove that cloyed your duds upon the chaties to trine." Footnote from the English Rogue, London, 1665. End of footnote. Conversation followed, not in the thieves' dialect of the song, for that was only used in talk when unfriendly ears might be listening. In the course of it, it appeared that John Hobbs was not altogether a new recruit, but had trained in the gang at some former time. His later history was called for, and when he said he had accidentally killed a man, considerable satisfaction was expressed. When he added that the man was a priest, he was roundly applauded, and had to take a drink with everybody. Old acquaintances welcomed him joyously, and new ones were proud to shake him by the hand. He was asked why he had tarried away so many months. He answered,
"London is better than the country, and safer these late years. The laws be so bitter and so diligently enforced, and I had not had that accident, I had stayed there. I had resolved to stay, and never more venture countrywards, but the accident has ended that."
He inquired how many persons the gang numbered now. The ruffler, or chief, answered,
25 sturdy budges, bulks, files, clapperdugins, and maunders, counting the dells and doxies and other morts.
Footnote. Canting terms for various kinds of thieves, beggars, and vagabonds, and their female companions. End of footnote.
"Most are here, the rest are wandering eastward along the winter lay. We follow at dawn. I do not see the Wen among the honest folk about me. Where may he be? Poor lad, his diet is brimstone now, and over hot for a delicate taste. He was killed in a brawl somewhere about midsummer. I sorrow to hear that. The Wen was a capable man and brave. That was he, truly. Black Bess, his dell, is of us yet, but absent on the eastward tramp. A fine lass, of nice ways and orderly conduct, none ever seeing her drunk above 4 days in the seven. She was ever strict, I remember it well. A goodly wench, and worthy all commendation. Her mother was more free and less particular, a troublesome and ugly-tempered beldame, but furnished with a wit above the common. We lost her through it. Her gift of palmistry and other sorts of fortune-telling begot for her at last a witch's name and fame.
The law roasted her to death at a slow fire. It did touch me to a sort of tenderness to see the gallant way she met her lot, cursing and rivaling all the crowd that gaped and gazed around her, whilst the flames licked upward toward her face and catched her thin locks and crackled about her old gray head. "Cursing them," said I, "cursing them! Why, an thou wouldst live a thousand years, thou'dst never hear so masterful a cursing. Alack, her art died with her. There be base and weakling imitations left, but no true blasphemy."
The ruffler sighed. The listeners sighed in sympathy. A general depression fell upon the company for a moment, for even hardened outcasts like these are not wholly dead to sentiment, but are able to feel a fleeting sense of loss and affliction at wide intervals and under peculiarly favoring circumstances, as in cases like to this, for instance, when genius and culture depart and leave no heir. However, a deep drink all round soon restored the spirits of the mourners.
"Have any others of our friends fared hardly?" asked Hobbs. "Some, yes, particularly newcomers, such as small husbandmen, turned shiftless and hungry upon the world because their farms were taken from them and to be changed to sheep ranges. They begged and were whipped at the cart's tail, naked from the girdle up, till the blood ran, then set in the stocks to be pelted. They begged again, were whipped again, and deprived of an ear. They begged a third time, poor devils, what else could they do? And were branded on the cheek with a red-hot iron, then sold for slaves. They ran away, were hunted down and hanged. 'Tis a brief tale and quickly told. Others of us have fared less hardly. Stand forth, Yokel, Burns, and Hodge. Show your adornments."
These stood up and stripped away some of their rags, exposing their backs, crisscrossed with ropy old welts left by the lash. One turned up his hair and showed the place where a left ear had once been. Another showed a brand upon his shoulder, the letter V, and a mutilated ear. The third said,
"I am Yokel, once a farmer and prosperous, with loving wife and kids. Now am I somewhat different in estate and calling, and the wife and kids are gone. Mayhap they are in heaven, mayhap in the other place. But the kindly God be thanked, they bide no more in England. My good old blameless mother strove to earn bread by nursing the sick. One of these died, the doctors knew not how, so my mother was burnt for a witch, whilst my babes looked on and wailed English law. Up all with your cups, now all together and with a cheer. Drink to the merciful English law that delivered her from the English hell. Thank you, mates, one and all. I begged from house to house, I and the wife, bearing with us the hungry kids, but it was crime to be hungry in England, so they stripped us and lashed us through three towns. Drink ye all again to the merciful English law, for its lash drank deep of my Mary's blood, and its blessed deliverance came quick. She lies there in the potter's field, safe from all harms. And the kids, well, whilst the law lashed me from town to town, they starved. Drink, lads, only a drop to the poor kids, that never did any creature harm. I begged again, begged for a crust, and got the stocks and lost an ear. See, here bides the stump. I begged again, and here's the stump of the other to keep me minded of it. And still I begged again, and was sold for a slave. Here on my cheek under this stain, if I washed it off, ye might see the red S, the branding iron left there. A slave. Do ye understand that word? An English slave, that is he that stands before ye. I have run from my master, and when I am found, the heavy curse of heaven fall on the law and the land that hath commanded it, I shall hang."
[Footnote: Enslaving. So young a king and so ignorant a peasant were likely to make mistakes, and this is an instance in point. The peasant was suffering from this law by anticipation. The king was venting his indignation against a law which was not yet in existence, for this hideous statute was to have birth in this little king's own reign. However, we know from the humanity of his character that it could never have been suggested by him. End of footnote. A ringing voice came through the murky air.
"Thou shalt not! And this day the end of that law is come!"
All turned and saw the fantastic figure of the little king approaching hurriedly. As it emerged into the light and was clearly revealed, a general explosion of inquiries broke out.
"Who is it? What is it? Who art thou, mannequin?"
The boy stood unconfused in the midst of all those surprised and questioning eyes, and answered with princely dignity,
"I am Edward, King of England."
A wild burst of laughter followed, partly of derision and partly of delight in the excellence of the joke. The king was stung. He said sharply,
"Ye mannerless vagrants, is this your recognition of the royal boon I have promised?"
He said more, with angry voice and excited gesture, but it was lost in a whirlwind of laughter and mocking exclamations. John Hobbs made several attempts to make himself heard above the din, and at last succeeded, saying,
"Mates, he is my son, a dreamer, a fool, and stark mad. Mind him not, he thinketh he is the king."
"I am the king," said Edward, turning toward him, "as thou shalt know to thy cost in good time. Thou hast confessed a murder. Thou shalt swing for it."
"Thou'lt betray me, thou, and I get my hands upon thee."
"Tut, tut," said the burly ruffler, interposing in time to save the king, and emphasizing this service by knocking Hobbs down with his fist.
"Hast respect for neither kings nor rufflers? And thou insult my presence so again, I'll hang thee up myself."
Then he said to his majesty, "Thou must make no threats against thy mates, lad, and thou must guard thy tongue from saying evil of them elsewhere. Be king, if it please thy mad humour, but be not harmful in it. Sink the title thou hast uttered. 'Tis treason.
We be bad men in some few trifling ways, but none among us is so base as to be traitor to his king. We be loving and loyal hearts in that regard. Note if I speak truth. Now, all together, long live Edward, King of England!"
"Long live Edward, King of England!"
The response came with such a thunder gust from the motley crew that the crazy building vibrated to the sound. The little king's face lighted with pleasure for an instant, and he slightly inclined his head and said with grave simplicity,
"I thank you, my good people."
This unexpected result threw the company into convulsions of merriment. When something like quiet was presently come again, the ruffler said, firmly but with an accent of good nature,
"Drop it, boy, 'tis not wise nor well. Humour thy fancy if thou must, but choose some other title."
A tinker shrieked out a suggestion,
"Fufu the First, King of the Moon Calves."
The title took at once. Every throat responded, and a roaring shout went up of,
"Long live Fufu the First, King of the Moon Calves,"
followed by hootings, catcalls, and peals of laughter.
"Hail him forth and crown him, robe him, sceptre him, throne him."
These and 20 other cries broke out at once, and almost before the poor little victim could draw a breath, he was crowned with a tin basin, robed in a tattered blanket, throned upon a barrel, and sceptred with the tinker's soldering iron. Then all flung themselves upon their knees about him, and sent up a chorus of ironical wailings and mocking supplications, whilst they swabbed their eyes with their soiled and ragged sleeves and aprons.
"Be gracious to us, O sweet king! Trample not upon thy beseeching worms, O noble majesty! Pity thy slaves, and comfort them with a royal kick! Cheer us and warm us with thy gracious rays, O flaming sun of sovereignty! Sanctify the ground with the touch of thy foot, that we may eat the dirt and be ennobled! Deign to spit upon us, O sire, that our children's children may tell of thy princely condescension, and be proud and happy forever!"
But the humorous tinker made the hit of the evening, and carried off the honours. Kneeling, he pretended to kiss the king's foot, and was indignantly spurned, whereupon he went about begging for a rag to paste over the place upon his face which had been touched by the foot, saying it must be preserved from contact with the vulgar air, and that he should make his fortune by going on the highway and exposing it to view at the rate of 100 shillings a sight. He made himself so killingly funny that he was the envy and admiration of the whole mangy rabble. Tears of shame and indignation stood in the little monarch's eyes, and the thought in his heart was,
"Had I offered them a deep wrong, they could not be more cruel. Yet have I proffered naught but to do them kindness, and it is thus they use me for it."
End of chapter 17.